We dedicate the merit of this video to the Dharma Kings, and may they spread the merit all throughout, everywhere, so it reaches everywhere. Of course, it will reach everywhere. Whatever merit accumulates from doing this video, it's not just for me, it's for everyone. It's for absolutely everyone. So, it's very important to realize this, that everything that we do is for everyone. Now, it's a very important video. We'll start out by talking about a little analogy. I'm wearing my Tiger Woods golf hat. Why? We'll start off with an analogy. Tiger Woods was responsible for the massive resurgence of interest in golf in the world for about 20 years. And before that, it was just blah. You know, it's just, once Jack Nicklaus faded away, and there was nothing, golf needs superstars. And Tiger Woods came along, and nobody has been a bigger superstar than he was. And so, but now that he's faded away, they say the golf attendance is way, way down. Like if he's going to play at a tournament now, it's just packed, you know, sold out, frenzy kind of thing. If he's not there, ticket sales are like one quarter or something. They're way down. People just aren't interested. You don't have that household name playing. This is the trouble. Superstars are very important. To really, our imagination has to be captured, and we have to realize that, you know, this is something extraordinary that's going on. Really extraordinary. Otherwise, we just can't get into it. Now, I remember I got energized by Tiger Woods to play golf. Absolutely did. I was previously energized by Jack Nicklaus to get into it, and then my interest sort of waned, and then Tiger Woods came along and said, wow, you know, maybe I can play like he plays. You know, he showed us, you know, this is how you can play golf. I said, are you kidding me? That's pretty interesting. It is possible to play like this. So when you see someone doing something extraordinary, you say, wow, I could do this too. Let me start working at it. So I've been working at it for Tiger's been around like almost 20 years now, really. If you talked about his amateur career. And I'm still working at it. How about that? But I don't play anymore. But I haven't given up working at it. Now, this is very interesting. We make an analogy with the great spiritual, the Dharma Kings, those who really moved the needle. Who has really moved the needle throughout history? Okay, I mean, you have Moses in the old times, and you have, you know, the Krishna. You have Buddha for sure, right? And then you have Jesus Christ, really moved the needle, superstar, okay? Then you can go to Padmasambhava, superstar, who maybe has been the most successful one of them all in terms of generating results. Then you have Muhammad, and you have, more recent times, you have, well, then Longchenpa, superstar. He's you know, been extremely effective in leading us to liberation, many to liberation. Tibetan Buddhism. Then you have modern times, Ram Maharshi, superstar. He moved the needle, didn't he? And then Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, superstar. Jamyang Khyentse Chokyi Lodro, superstar in Tibetan Buddhism. Understated superstar, but no doubt superstar. So they really were able to capture the imagination of the people. And people realized there's a goal that I want to aspire to. There's a goal I want to aspire to. And somehow they started working at it. Like for many, many people, I know someone who started golf because he watched Tiger Woods on television and said, oh my gosh, I want to be like that. And he's now a scratch golfer. You know, he's a really, really good golfer now because he just said, "Man, I want to do this," and he started doing it. That's the power of stardom. Whereas he watched someone else, he just wasn't interested. But something about the dynamism. Okay, that was Tiger Woods. He wanted to do it. So many people are like that. They get inspired by some superstar and say, I want to do this. This is why I call upon the Dharma Kings to help out right now, because the world is so uninspired right now. We're in the blahs. We're really in the blahs. And it, so we need help. We need help. And a superstar has a cast of characters around them that help spread it out and fill out the stage. Fill out the stage, right? Baba Sanva had his, what, 25 or 26 disciples, close disciples, and they, all of them, help spread his, teachings all throughout Tibet. They filled out the stage, but he was a bigger than life character. So we need these bigger than life characters to come on the stage to really capture our imagination. And when they're gone, here's the trouble. When they're gone, what happens? Now, historically, culture is passed on. Religious culture is passed on in the through the family unit, through especially through the female side, the mothers, the grandmothers, the aunts, and that who raise the children, who are at home with the children, and they transmit to the children what the cultural expectations are. That's how it works here. That's not happening anymore. Now the cultural expectations are being transmitted by television and smartphone and tablets. Okay? They're not being transmitted by the women anymore. Very much at all. And so when a spiritual superstar leaves the stage, this sets us up for remembrance and calling them to mind. In religious culture, we're supposed to call to mind the saints and the saviors and the sages. Talk about the stories, what they said, their lives, what they taught, the disciplines they want us to do, and all of that. And this it's religious culture. So religious culture talks about the saints and those who are instrumental in establishing their religion, and that's the conversation. The conversation should be religious based conversation. The music also. The whole culture should be that way. In order to really overcome our bias against certainty, this is necessary. There's no way the bias against certainty and then the resulting familiarity fear, is so severe. There isn't any way to get free of it except to really inculturate it. You can have a few mavericks and anomalies here and there, but as t in terms of just about everyone, without us. Religious, spiritual culture, they don't stand a chance against the tide. They'll be swept away by doubt. They'll be swept away by doubt. There's only a few characters who can stand up to it, and it's very, very difficult. And that's what's happened right now. I can't find anybody on Facebook, hardly anyone that can stand up to it. They're trying to fit truth into secular humanism. They're trying so hard to do that, into secular humanistic materialism, which is a very fallen state to be in. To say it's the Kali Yuga, the Dark Age, where everyone tries to, find a way. How can we be happy with doubt? They don't believe they can get free of doubt. They don't believe it anymore, because even though we've had superstars, two great, two of the best ever in our times, maybe three, really. And others that are really solid, the tide of secular materialistic humanism has been so strong. And what happens is when we start getting this disease of affluence, it's easy to lure the women out of the house and into frantically pursuing money and power and position so they can have more and more affluence. And then the children get turned over to Big Brother, Big Mother to raise them. They turn over the educational system, and the educational system gives them all their values, which is a disaster because you're not supposed to teach religion in secular education. Okay, so you get the women away from the children, then the state, you see, statism wants to run, teach your children. This is what's happened in this world, is statism is destroyed the transmission of culture. And you see, like the traditional houses, like I see pictures from my Facebook friends from India, and the house, is full of women, and the children are there, and so there's always women around, mature women, to turn the child in the direction that they think culture should be like. And so they'll be teaching them little religious songs, sayings, customs, habits, all the time. They're the teachers. And there's always teachers there to teach them culture. Whereas in our modern secular humanistic materialistic world, the so-called modern culture, I talk, I mean, I asked somebody, what are you doing? And they said, well, I got to take my kid to daycare. I say, what do you mean? Yeah, daycare, some sort of daycare. And they're like 1 year old. I mean, they're so young, they're like babies, and they just ship them off to daycare because the mother's working full time. Why? So they can buy a new car, and a new house, and new this, and keep up with this materialistic lifestyle, affluent lifestyle. Meanwhile, the kids being entertained by dinosaurs on television and tablets. This is crazy. It's absolutely crazy. It's the ruination of spiritual culture in the world, and it's already pretty ruined. The Indian culture, Tibetan culture, traditional culture seem to be the only place where people have much sanity left anymore. But even they are being corrupted very quickly. It's collapsing. Once a dam collapses, the water's going to leave that reservoir. It might be some part of the dam still remaining, but if there's a big enough hole in the dam, all the water's going to run out. And that's what's happened. There's no more water in the reservoir. So, I mean, is it repairable at this point? Well, for one thing, you have to get rid of the ideal of affluence. That's a terrible ideal. And this doesn't mean destitution. The idea that, well, if you're not affluent, you're going to be destitute, is just a complete lie. It's a complete lie, isn't it? You can be humble. You can have enough to get by on. I mean, I'm happy to wear clothes until they wear out. I don't. I'll wear something. Especially, I used to. I mean, just 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 years. I used to wear my shoes until they're just completely, gone. Utterly worn out. And I felt perfectly happy with that. I said, well, why, that's just the way it should be. But these days, everything is disposable. People get shoes every 6 months. And of course, some just go shopping continuously, right? A lot of women are shopaholics now. And this is horrible. So the affluence is the worst disease in the world, actually. It's the worst disease in the world, affluence. We have all these prosperity so-called pseudo-spiritual teachers saying, yeah, do this, affirm this, you can do this, God wants you to have affluence and wants you this. That is such a rotten teaching. It's utterly rotten. Now, in this affluent culture, we don't want to look like we're destitute, so we feel like we need to, for me, I just feel like I need to have just a few clothes that I look like, oh, maybe he's affluent. But other than that, I don't have anything. But I have to at least publicly look like, well, I'm part of the group, part of the world like that. But it's not true at all. I generally try to keep things as long as possible. As long as possible. I hate buying new stuff. I want to whatever works, keep using it. So this is, anti-affluent attitude. It's a spiritual attitude. So really, this world can be helpful to us spiritually when we struggle and just have enough to get by on. Then we spend time in contemplation. Whereas if we have all this abundance and affluence, we forget all about it. We forget all about it. And actually, people are working more frantically now than ever. For more, because there's so much affluence and stuff is being. The styles are changing. Once you get this disease, and I went through this. I put myself through a lot of phases so I could understand everyone in this world, what their problems were. I said, okay, I'll get addicted to affluence, that ideal, and see what it's like. And it's horrible. It's horrible. It's really horrible. Shopping. I hate shopping now. I used to shop constantly. Now I hate it. Rang up big debts too, so I know what debts are like. It's horrible. But the disease of affluence causes you to get indebted also. Indebtedness is really terrible. All the stuff in the world, materialism is terrible, actually. It's the worst disease there is. As Dogen, Dogen, said, the Zen saying it is, outside of the Dharma, enlightenment's the most important thing there is. That's a great statement, isn't it? Other than the Dharma, enlightenment is the most important. Is most important. Other than the Dharma, enlightenment is most important. Meaning, the Dharma, of course, is more important. Dharma is more important than enlightenment. This is true. This is true. Because you won't get to enlightenment without Dharma, without a Dharmic culture, okay, which is a culture not based on affluence. Now, we thought the middle class was going to be the answer, and it turns out it could have been. For me, it was the answer, but that middle class is collapsing, and this disease of affluence now with all the automation and machinery and roboticism and everything, it's not going to go away anytime soon, is it, from this world? And so basically, the world's doomed. Because you can't have your cake and eat it too. You cannot be caught up in the cycle of affluence, which is never ending. I mean, it's just an avalanche, an unceasing avalanche of stuff. And you get drunk on it. I know you get drunk on it, very, very drunk on it. Men and women, but especially women get drunk on it because it seems to be the answer to their prayers. They don't have to worry about their children. Of course, what women are afraid of is that the children will go wanting or something like that. But you know what? Children are quite happy with simple stuff. For me, just give me a baseball and a glove, and I'll just play catch all day. Or give me a frisbee. That's all I need. I'll run around barefoot if I need to. Kids are taught affluence by their parents and by culture and society. Children are not naturally obsessed with affluence. Most of them, they're not. They just love playing. They just love playing. Just give me a sandbox. Just take me to the ocean. Just simple stuff. Simple stuff. So affluence is something that is forced onto us. We're pressured into it by marketing and a whole decadent culture, actually. And we want to automate that now so it becomes perpetual. Bring in Marxism and have central planning and make sure that everybody has affluence and has ability to stay addicted to affluence. We wouldn't want anybody to not be affluent, would we? Right? But the ones who have been enlightened in the history, generally they were not affluent. Look at Buddha. He left affluence. He rejected affluence, right? That's one of the key points of what he did. He just said, you know, this doesn't work for me. I mean, what's going on here? What's really going on in this world? Longchenpa, no affluence there. Lived in caves. Padmasambhava, you know, not. I don't think he had affluence at all. Traveled, constantly traveling, visiting yogis and enlightened ones. And Jesus, certainly no affluence there, right? What kind of affluence did Jesus Christ have? But did he teach affluence teaching that all this, you know, so many Christians are into now? Is that what Jesus taught? Affluence teachings? Prosperity teachings? Is that the way? Anandamayi, what kind of affluence? Nothing. She never even touched money or anything to do with money. Ramana, he gave away all his money and his clothes when he was like 16, 15 or 16. Never touched money again in his life. Never even gave it a thought. No affluence, Ramana. Okay. Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro, the same way. No affluence. Very strict, austere kind of lives. The Dharma kings are very austere. And believe in an austere lifestyle and not an affluent lifestyle. That's not to say that they believe in some sort of destitute lifestyle. Not at all. We don't have to be bereft. For instance, golf, people think, well, it's affluent. Well, it's because it costs so much to maintain the golf courses. But as far as just a ball in a club is pretty simple. It's really simple, isn't it? You just go out there and you just hit this ball around. Some grass. I'd be happy playing in the desert. I'd be happy playing in the Sahara Desert or something. Why not just put, you know, just, it's just fun to like swing at the ball and hit it. And, you know, simple pleasures like that. But unfortunately, it's too expensive. I can't afford it. I cannot afford to play golf at this point. But I would allow myself to do that. I mean, you don't have to, but still, I'm still austere in my overall, in my mind. You know, I do not allow materialism to get into me. And so you have to be this way in today's world. You just have to play the fool, act like you're into it, but actually not be into it at all. It's difficult. It's difficult. It's easier if you're just poor. I mean, as far as austere society, it would be easier because, you know, you're just very simple life. Get up in the morning and go to bed at night. You don't need any of the stuff that we have, really. You just need a way to cook some food, right? And some sanitation, a way to cook some food. And then you could spend time in right practice. And so this is the way most religious spiritual people have been throughout history, actually. And this is what actually works. Now, why is this and how is this? It seems like pretty shocking. You're like, oh, it's too tough. Well, again, we don't have to drop out and live in a cave, but we better understand what's going on here. And the importance of spiritual practice, the importance of it. Because if we don't do it, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? Well, we just need to look at what's going on in the world. Everybody going to their deaths, drugged up like crazy with all their money going to pharmaceutical companies, and you'll see what's going to happen to you. But it doesn't have to be that way at all. The opportunity that austerity presents us is really eternal life. That's actually Jesus, very simple. Look, I come to bring you eternal life, meaning I come to bring you the teachings, the culture that will lead you to eternal life. I come to bring you the culture and the skillful means so you will realize you have eternal life. And though the lazy ones just said, oh no, you came to bring us eternal life, so your sacrificial atonement brought us all eternal life, and all we got to do is eat some wafer every Sunday and we have it too, which is just laziness. That's not what Jesus said at all. He said the body profiteth nothing. So what he did was he came to bring a culture, to start a culture. He had his apostles start a culture of austerity and religious and spiritual practice. Okay, so this is what the superstars do. They bring an entire culture with them. They bring an enculturation. Now, videos are better than books and writing. That's why I do videos. I don't write. I realize that in books, there's no way to convey the pauses that we have, the silence that we have here. There's no way to convey that. I do dot, dot, dot. But is that a 1 second pause or like a minute? And what's the expression? What's the feeling of the pause? So videos are way more effective than writing, I would say. Writing is very problematical. You don't get the flavor of what's going on. You really don't. That's why saints are so important in the world, is for people to actually see them and get the flavor of it. That's what's powerful. Writing, not so powerful. Not so powerful. Just, you get a mental concept, mental image, mental picture. But you don't get the real flavor and intensity of it. Like videos of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, they're more powerful than the pictures. I mean, the pictures are super powerful, but videos, you see how she moves and acts, and the flow of her, you know, of her play, the flow, just like, oh my gosh, it's amazing, you know, it's just astonishing. Is it even more? I'd love to have more videos. All right, that's one thing that I know there's some videos somewhere that they're private, though someone posted them, but didn't want people to really spread them around, you know. But there were a whole bunch of hours and hours of videos of her. I don't know where they are, but there's some videos of her that are just so amazing, you know, you just almost pass out. You can't believe it. How could anyone be this way? When she's walking around and moving and expressions are changing, and you know, just the quick change of expression and the flow of a feeling through her is like lightning. It's like lightning. And it's just you know, we've never seen anything like it. Never seen anything remotely like that, actually. So that's more powerful. She didn't do writing. She didn't leave books or writing or anything, because it was her presence that was powerful, you see. And she let people see her presence. And that really gets into you. That really gets into you at a very deep level. Very, very deep level. Words are cheap. Writing's even cheaper, actually. It's just, you know, on a page just like this, and you where's the flavor of that? It's very dry. Where are the gestures? Where's the intonation? Where are the pauses? Where's the expressions? You know, where's the presence? Where's the ambience? Where's the flow? You know, where's all that? It's very, very, very separated from that out, isn't it? The written word. Really, if you're blessed enough to spend time with a Dharma king, that's so powerful. Oh, you know, more than the written word, it leaves a lasting impression. Now, the written word has a certain place, but it's not, should not be primary, actually. Should not be primary. So I try to get people used to this notion of you know, watching videos is way more effective than the written word or an image, a picture, you know. A picture is worth 1,000 words, they say. But a video is worth, you know, 1,000,000 pictures, you could say, actually. It is, isn't it? The cadence of speech, just everything is there. There's no cadence in written words. It's just whatever you know, want it to be, think it should be, but it's not necessarily, you know, if you saw somebody, it would be like reading a musical score and thinking, well, that, yeah, okay, I get it. I get the music. I read this musical score. I mean, who sits around reading musical scores? I mean, wouldn't you rather listen to music? I mean, who just reads the lyrics of a song? I mean, wouldn't you rather listen to the song? Right? It's the song that's important. It's the song that's important. So, not so much just the lyrics. Lyrics are so dry. Where's the music? We want the music. So, videos are like music. They're like music. And I greatly prefer that to writing a book. People of the book, they say, well, we got one Messiah, we don't want any others, we want to just get it from a book. That's you know, I've just pointed out, that's like we want to spend our time just reading lyrics to a song and not hearing the song. Who wants that, really? I don't want that. I want to hear the song. Now, Sri Sri Nandamayama, Rama Harshi, or the Dharma Kings can convey a song just from their picture. That is true. If you're really receptive, you can feel the wellspring of song there. That is, it seems like it's bursting out of the image, so to speak. It's very rare to see that. But seeing them actually in their person, would be, you know, much more astonishing. And effective. So we have this bias against that, especially Judeo-Christianity. You know, I mean, the Protestants, they just want Jesus and nothing else. You know, they're waiting for him to come back. But in the meantime, and Catholics, they can't come up with any saints anymore. I mean, they come up with some, you know, people they call blessed, that they're blessed, you know, like Mother Teresa. I would say she's blessed, if you want to say that. She's a tireless social worker, but a saint? No. Someone who's realized, you know, free of doubt, free of time space, the belief in time space process and form. No way. Blessed. So they haven't come up with any saints. You don't see the saints in the world anymore. In the Christian tradition, they just don't seem to be any at all. Or I don't know who you would say is. Other traditions aren't doing too well now either, actually. You have characters, spiritual characters. Okay. It's not the same as a Dharma king, as a saint. It's not the same. So here we pray to the Dharma Kings and saying, Dharma Kings, we need your help. We need your help in whatever which way you can help. Without your help, how can culture be regenerated? I mean, it's so degenerate now, it doesn't seem possible to regenerate it, because the education that children are getting from the moment they're born is coming from the Tektronix folks who are very reptilian in nature, actually, and not that is something that is insurmountable. You know, it can be surmounted. It can be surmounted, but we certainly don't want them enculturating our children. I mean, there's a place for stuff. There's a place for stuff, but our job is to get free of doubt. Okay, to overcome our bias against certainty. It's everyone's job. It's everyone's responsibility. So that has to come first. That has to come first. And in this culture we have now, it puts the wrong stuff first and the right stuff last. So they've got it backwards. So now what do we do? I don't know exactly. However, it needs to be mentioned. It needs to be mentioned that the path still works. Okay, well, if you really do what you're supposed to do, it works. It will work for you. It will work for anyone. This morning I got on the right side of bed. I don't know how that happened. It's a combination of everything, of just the progress I've made and all the prayer I've made, you know, the prayers I made yesterday and all the time with the Dharma Kings, looking at the pictures of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, studying Longchenpa, etc. The great apex yoga practice I've been doing. It's ripening the fruit. It's ripening the fruit. The spiritual path, you can say, is called the ripening of the fruit. You have to ripen the fruit. So I got up on the right side of the bed today, and I went outside, and I for some reason, I looked up at the sky. And I said, oh my gosh, the sky's beautiful today. Wow, how beautiful. And then I began driving, and everything looked beautiful. I said, wow, what is this? So I spent the entire morning driving around in very kind of slowly. I just said, wow. And everything had this feeling of soft gentleness, soft gentle beauty to it. And it's an imperceptibleness. It's imperceptibleness, and yet it's there. It's everywhere. And how can you perceive everywhere? Who is outside? Who is the perceiver of everywhereness is the question. And so I realized I had the peace of God this morning. The whole world was wrapped in this super gentle, soft peace of God. Indescribably so, you know, it's indescribably so. Imperceptibly so. It was there. It was everywhere. I said, well, this is it. This is it. And so I'd be just practicing. Wow, this is it. Wow, this is it. Wow, this is it. And it comes in. It creeps up on, you know, if you call it enlightenment. I don't like the term enlightenment, really, because I think it's not the right term, really, unless you understand what the light of God. It's clear light. It was just the subtle, gentle ambience. And then I remembered, oh, this is how I used to feel. And this is what I love the most. It was, everything was immersed in this and bathed in this, just this feeling of super gentle softness everywhere. And later on in the day, I began to have breakthroughs, and I realized, well, why can't I keep this? So everything was smooth. It was so smooth. There was the complete smoothness to everything. Everything felt like it had this soft, gentle smoothness in terms of just this what it is. You know, it was everywhere. It was God everywhere. And so subtle, you know, like I call it, it's imperceptible. It's imperceptible. You can't perceive it, but it's there. Awareness is aware of it. So I became aware of God this morning, and then later on I had these insights. What happened was, I turned on this CD player in my vehicle and was playing Beach Boys. And I put on Warmth of the Keep an Eye on Summer. Keep an Eye on Summer. Beautiful, beautiful ballad by the Beach Boys. Keep an Eye on Summer. And I started singing to it, and I said, oh my gosh, rarely have I ever sung like this before. And I was singing so beautifully and smoothly. I was singing like the way I felt, what I was experiencing, I was singing that way. And then I kind of stopped. I was kind of shocked. I said, oh, you know. And it dawned upon me, when the peace of God imperceptibly dawns upon you, and it's an imperceptible dawning, actually. Okay, it's very important to understand this. There's no way you can perceive the dawning of it. It's an imperceptible dawning. It's just one morning you get up and you go out and you just sort of notice, oh, the sky is so beautiful. What a beautiful sky. You know, just like that. It's an imperceptible dawning. Very important to practice in this way, to say this imperceptible dawning. That when this dawns upon you, everything you do has this beautiful smoothness to it. Just like my singing had suddenly changed. And it sounded so beautiful. So much so that I stopped. It's kind of shocking. And then I realized that when the peace of God dawns upon you, everyone is going to see you as lovely and beautiful and graceful, and they're going to be, it's going to touch them, you know. It's going to, they'll feel something. Even the people you hate. Okay, even the people you hate. And when the peace of God comes upon you, you can't hate. You can't hate. Because everything looks beautiful. Everything has this soft gentleness to it. This gentle glory to it. Manjushri means gentle glory. Everything has this gentle glory to it. And you can't hate anything. And I said, wow. Amazing. And so this is why your spiritual teachings teach this thing's falling. This palm frond. I came to this guy who was cutting down these palm fronds from a tree, and I said, "Hey, can I have one of those?" And I took one. He says, "Do you want more?" I said, "Ah, I don't know. Maybe I only need one." And I thought later on, I thought, "Well, maybe I'll get some more." So I got five of them, five palm fronds. But you gotta be careful because they've got very strong thorns on them. That's right. They have, but they're beautiful. So I realized that, for instance, even the reptilians, you would see them as gentle glory. You know, even the ones you hate, the political people you hate, you'd see them with gentle glory, and they would see you and they'd say, "Oh, so beautiful, so wonderful." And so it's the end of hate. It's the end of hate. You can't hate anymore. And so you nourish, it's like the sun nourishes everything. Everything is nourished by your presence. Everything. Even all the people you can't stand. Even the liberals, even the conservatives, depending, you know, how you feel. It's like, oh my gosh, they're all gonna be uplifted by this, you know. You don't have any choice. You don't have any choice. And so I realize why politics is so bad to be in. You know, when you're on the path, you can't be involved in politics, actually. You cannot. I don't vote. I don't involve myself in politics at all. other, what I point out is that the dialectic is so dangerous for us. I'm independent. Because you can't hate on the spiritual. You're going toward a situation where everything is beautiful, everything is graceful, everything is God. And there's no way that you can hate anyone. Even the most loathsome people, and the problematic people, etc., etc. At least those that you feel that way. So there's so much hate right now in the world, towards in politics, isn't there? There's so much hate. Like if you, so it's getting in the way of God realization. Because if you told like a liberal that when they have God realization, they're going to see Trump as this you know, beautiful soul, and as much love towards him as anyone else, and you would love to give him the opportunity to come and be graced by your presence. You know, if you told that to a liberal, they would reject God rather than think about that. I mean, the idea is so abhorrent to them. So abhorrent that they can't even think of such a thing. Now, I understand that. It's not easy. I mean, I feel a lot of people feel similar to the previous president, that it is quite abhorrent. But you have to get past that. You have to get past that. It's like that's our, you know, we grind on that. Say, oh my gosh, you mean, you know, I got, they will seem just as lovely and beautiful. Yeah, everything will. Everything will. And it's just like if you're singing beautifully, you know, to an audience, you know, you don't know who's in the audience, but they're all being blessed by beautiful singing. There could be some people that politically you totally disagree with, you see. But if you're going to be a beautiful singer, you cannot get caught up in politics. If you're part of the high culture, art, etc., you better be careful about that. Unless you're going to limit, you know, who can hear what you sing, if you want to limit it, but then, you know, that becomes rather problematical, because when the peace of God dawns upon you, you don't see it that way. You don't see it that way. You see it very differently. There's nothing that is you know, repulsive outside this peace of God, this gentle glory. There's nothing that's untouched by it. There's nothing that's untouched by it. So you have to see that. You, if you're liberal, you'd see that the Trump is totally touched by the glory of gentle glory of God, as all conservatives are, and vice versa. If you're conservative, you see that everyone, all the liberals, for instance, are touched by the gentle glory of God. Everything is. As I drove around, everything was bathed in this presence, this soft, gentle glory presence, just everywhere, equally everywhere, imperceptibly so, and yet we're aware of it. No dynamic causing it at all. It's still, it's quiet, it's silent. So if you're an artist, you produce music, you want to uplift everyone. You don't want to just uplift some political party. You want to uplift everyone. Maybe we'll have a concert and we'll have the liberals sit on one side and the conservatives sit on the other. We'll segregate the two so they won't, you know, to cool the animosity down. I mean, we're getting to that point now. The same thing with men and women. It'd be a good idea to segregate them in any sort of outpouring, actually, because there's tremendous bitterness and resentment going on, both ways, actually. But it's building up in men very much so. Like they feel like they're dogs, you know, like this. It's not good. So you might need to segregate the audience, but they should be both have the opportunity to be blessed by this grace, you know, the grace, the presence of grace. And it may very well come to that. I may have to do that. Actually, I was thinking about this intensive, and I'm always thinking of intensives. What can we do? And 100 days of summer is the name of the intensive I'm thinking of giving. But I have to give one for the liberals and one for the conservatives, because there's so much, you know, the abyss is terrible. And it should be one for the men and one for the women, too. You know, separate ones, separate. The women are so dominating right now of what's going on in the world, that the men just, I can't find hardly a single man in the world who isn't controlled by women right now. Almost, I might be the only one that's not. Maybe there's a few, and maybe they're having a real tough time. They just cannot. Everything they do has to be done, you can tell, with the approval of women. They can't do anything unless they feel that women will approve it. They can't. And when they try, they'll say one thing and then immediately backtrack and say, but, you know, I gotta make sure that's okay with mom, you know. Great thing about Ananda Maima is those who have this problem, she approves the grace of God, the peace of God coming upon you. She approves it. So that helps us get past the secular materialistic culture where the women want you to sit, you know, say spiritual things, but at the same time be a slave to affluence. Be a slave to affluence. This is the problem. This doesn't work. This doesn't work. It's a mixed message. So you're getting what I'm getting in Facebook is a lot of mixed messages. There's a lot of good stuff being said, but it's always the context is this mixed message. And then you say, and on the other side, here's my dog, you know. And my dog, you know, you got to please my dog. And if you don't please my dog, you're no good. And you know, kind of like that. It's funny. I was in this conversation with someone, and basically he was stuck. And I said, where can you go to when you die? Is there someplace other than everywhere? And he said, absolutely. I say, well, you know, where? And he puts up a dog icon with a question mark. Lovely, lovely guy. But, you know, so there was no answer when he was caught, you know, and realized, oh my gosh, I see truth now. I can't have that. He puts up a dog icon with a question mark. Like, the dog's kind of like going, like, oh, you're really caught. You're stressing me out. You're stressing me out. And that's exactly what's going on in culture right now. Is don't stress out my dog by telling me the truth. My dog doesn't like it. It was hilarious. It's absolutely hilarious. I'm getting this more and more. I'm starting to see, you know, how animals are being used as a defense mechanism for the ego. Absolutely they are. So you go to be blessed, you know, no dogs, no animals, no animals, no animals. That's to be very, very hard, fast rule. No animals are allowed. They never have been allowed in religious temples, religious churches, synagogues, you know, mosques, you name it. What do? You bring in your monkeys and your parrots and your rats and your guinea pigs and your hamsters and your, you know, dogs, your cats, your, you know, donkeys, camels. You bring them inside the church or whatever. I mean, what? No, you don't. No, you don't, but that's what the world's coming to. So maybe let's have a separate area for animals, coming up. The people are so crazy these days. Really suffering very badly from continuity fear, you know. They're suffering very badly from it. So stressed. They just say, gosh, because they're trying to please both the ego and the Holy Spirit at the same time, and they can't do it. It's driving them nuts. They just can't commit to God. They can't commit. They say, I gotta please affluence also. You know, I gotta please my affluence also. Guy today, super wealthy guy, wonderful guy. He's like, I said, how you doing? He asked me, I said, for me, it's just a glorious day, I told him. And he's kind of like moping around. And he goes, and then finally he says, well, God, I said, finally I finished my honeydew list, you know. And I can finally do something of just, relating and stuff. Meaning I finally dealt with all the issues of affluence that I have to grind through every day for my wife, I know got a lot of guys that are retired, and I say, how is it? They say, it's terrible, because I got a honey-do list that never ends. They're constantly kept busy trying to, chase this, rainbow of affluence for their wives. They want this, they want this, they want this, they want this, they want, it never ends. And they have no, they say, God, I got no time for myself. I thought when I retired, I'd have time to, for myself. No. Whereas in traditional countries, if the man retires from his job, the children are raised, he's allowed to spend the rest of his life in contemplation, like in India. That was the tradition. This should be so, shouldn't it? Here, they don't even have a moment for that. The wife keeps him hopping because she's addicted to this affluence thing. Fortunately, my wife, I'm allowed to do this taping. I say, hey, I'm going to tape now. Is that okay? She goes, sure. So she lets me have all the time I want for myself because I insist upon it. I insist upon it. And I say, this is how it is, and this is what I'm going to do. But she's gotten used to it. You see, she said, yeah, okay, sure. I can, I can do what I'm doing, and that's not a problem. But, I do give the courtesy of asking, do the courtesy of asking, but, I'm going to do it anyway. Right? I'm going to do it anyway. And so men, they have to insist upon it. And fortunately, my wife, previously, in her younger days, had massive affluence and lived that whole life of massive affluence. And she said, I'm sick of it. It's not the answer. I'm sick of it. So she's not really into it anymore. She's really not into it. She just says just a few simple things and I'm good. I don't really need that stuff. She's had all the diamonds and everything. And gave it all away. She gave it all away. She says, this is killing me. It's killing me. It's terrible. Fame, everything. Everything you'd want in affluence. And she says, this is just pulling me down into hell is all it's doing. It's a snake pit. I'm one of the few men in the world, I guess, that can, do this. But I insist upon it. And the Holy Spirit helps me. And it used to be that way. Women used to be that way. The man would say, because they weren't addicted to affluence, the man would say, I'm going to go to church now. I'm going to go pray. I'm going to read the Bible. She said, well, great. I'm going to spend some time reading the Bible too. So, I go tape, you go tape, or you go to spiritual stage, your wife, she spends time reading the Bible, reading some holy books, saying prayers and things like that. That's the way home life should be, actually. It's the way home life's supposed to be. If you want the peace of God to imperceptibly dawn upon you like it happened to me this morning. And then later on, busy with the day, talking to people, I became aware there's like a thin haze sort of covering up the peace of God, just this very thin haze. And I said, yeah, okay, that happened. And again, I realized like, oh my gosh, you're going to love everyone. When the peace of God descends upon you, you love everyone. And for all these political activists in the world, activists, period, okay, they're haters, okay, let's be very honest, they're haters. They love to hate because someone's interfering with their affluence, they think. And they hate them. And hate is an addiction. Hate is an addiction. It really is. You have to break that addiction. Now, you don't have to bow to the leaders of the opposition or something like that. But you just simply ignore them. You just, for me, like the previous president, I just ignored him. I paid no attention to him. So I didn't hate him. I mean, I would talk about some of the trends in the world and how, people shouldn't be idolizing him and stuff. That's a very bad thing. But in terms of my emotions and thoughts, I never mentioned his name. I never paid attention to him. So I wouldn't hate on him. I wouldn't get this habit of hate. Wouldn't get the habit of hate. So those who hate Trump, they shouldn't talk about him at all. They shouldn't. They should just completely ignore him, and refuse to read any news articles, and pay no attention to him, just like he was some person, you know, down the street neighbor that you never see. Basically, if you see him, say, "Hey, just wave, how you doing?" And that's it. So you don't get in the habit of hate. The habit of hate is one of the worst habits you can have. It, for sure, it will block the peace of God in you. For sure it will block it. This is what I discovered today. For sure it will block it. And you'll end up talking a good game. You see, what happens is you might get a glimpse of the peace of God, and then you'll go back to hating. But then you can talk a good game. And then people think that you're some kind of spiritual teacher, actually. But you're really not. You're teaching a mixed message. You can't abide in the peace of God. You cannot be aware of it continuously if you have this habit of hate. So I see all these spiritual people who talk a good game, and they can't help but constantly posting about Trump, trying to demonize him in every possible way. There's all these GIFs and videos and pictures. You know, it's just a culture of demonization. You know, which I don't care who it is. That's terrible for you. It's terrible for you because you're getting this habit of hate and demonization, which will absolutely block the peace of God from descending upon, from imperceptibly dawning upon you. It will absolutely block that, and then you will believe in death. You will continue to believe in death, and you will not know eternal life. You will not. You will think there's somewhere you can go to die. Okay, but if the peace of God dawns upon you imperceptibly, you will realize there's nowhere to go to die. How can I die? There's nowhere. Where do you go to die? God's everywhere. So if you hate somebody, what you're really doing is you're imagining your own death is all you're doing. You're imagining your own death because you think that they are outside of God and they're hateful because of it, and therefore there's some place to go to die. You won't escape that place either. If you believe there's somewhere outside of God, you will not escape that place, and you will believe it's death for you. This is absolutely true. Jesus is so right about everything he says in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words. He's so right. Give and you shall receive. So God is everywhere. There's nowhere you can go to die. There's nowhere you can go to die. So, you know, brutal. Facebook is brutal. It's a brutal place, actually. It's a jungle, brutal jungle of mixed messages and pretty butts, I would call it. But I have, here's a nice pretty picture, but, like that, mixed message, but, I hate Trump. So you get, you know, here's 20, like, beautiful pictures with spiritual sayings on it, and then here's a photo saying, Trump is the devil, I want him dead, you know, that's, you know, like that. It's like, but... I got that from this. Someone requested a friendship of me. I just confirm everybody, and I get some really bizarre ones. You know, Facebook is just like a jungle. It's a jungle, and it was just. I got one request of a profile picture. It was this woman by a pool in a thong. You know, with her butt there. You know, so you know, and I said, "What the hell?" You know, I said, "That's terrible." You know, why is anyone asking me to befriend me? It has such a profile picture, you know, and it's just like, I said, well, God wants me to friend everyone, so I did. And then later on, I suddenly got what it was, because everything is grace to me. And what that person was doing, it was the grace of an online mod. I said, why did you send me that? You know, it's like pornographic, really. And she's saying Facebook is just pretty butts, is all it is. Pretty butts, in other words. I said, I got it. I said, oh my gosh, that's what it's true, isn't it? It's like, look at this pretty truth, but I hate Trump. I hate conservatives. I hate people who don't love animals. I hate, like, there's like, they have a list of stuff they hate that never ends. They're haters. isn't this pretty, but, you see, isn't this picture, you know, of gorgeous nature and this lovely, you know, non-dual saying, isn't that pretty, but, a pretty but, you get that? And so, that whoever asked a friendly was actually, it was the grace of God. You see how amazing it is? That was cluing me, tipping me off to, this is Facebook now. This is what's going on here. So I didn't reject them. I didn't reject. See, when you don't reject, you find out it's the grace of God. If you're willing to put it together. And it's the disease of affluence says, no, we got to have both. We got to have the peace of God, but also affluence. But as we have found out, affluence, we were told, what was it? I was talking to somebody, they were working, and I remember it was. We were talking, it's like, I said, man, the grind just never ends, does it? We're talking about the commute, and he said, the commute's never good. I said, was the commute good today? He said, it's never good. It's never, ever good. It's never good. I said, you know, what weren't we told when we grew up that affluence would free us up and free us up to have all this wonderful time on our hands and a relaxed, calm, peaceful, relaxed life? And he says, yeah, that's what they told us, isn't it? What a lie. What a lie. What a lie. What a lie. We're more distracted now than ever. I mean, the guys work, and the women too. They work all day long, right? People are battling commutes 4 and 5 hours. Sometimes I talk to people, this commute into work, how much longer is commute into there? It took me 5 hours a day, some accidents and stuff. And then it took them 5 hours to get home. 10-hour commute in one day. Some of them, 3-4 hours one way. So they have a 6 to 7 hour commute. That's common here. You're in your car commuting that long, okay? Then you frantically work all day trying to please all these women who are obsessed with affluence. When you have time for yourself, and then you get on the weekends, it's honey-do list. This is the life that men are leading, and they're just like completely wiped out. They're completely frazzled, and their spirituality has just gone down the toilet. You know, they've lost it. So affluence has really caused us to lose our spirituality, especially, you know, those who don't want to lose it. We thought we were told when all this affluence, after World War II is when it really started, we were told by the scientists and the social engineers that we're going to set up this affluent society for you, and you're going to have all this free time on your hands. It's going to be absolutely amazing. And you'll be able to, said, all we need for you is to work really hard at this for a while and forget about your spiritual studies for a while and build this great society, the great society, Lyndon Baines Johnson, the great society, the great culture. And then you'll be able to get back to your spiritual teaching and it'll be awesome for you. So that was the great lie. And so we abandoned our spiritual path in order to slave away and bring building this great, you know, automated affluent society. And guess what? We've lost touch with our spirituality, all those great habits. We're now completely harassed by affluence from every angle. And we're doomed. Okay, so they lied to us, the scientists and the technicians and stuff. They're liars, okay, plain and simple. Severe liars. I spend all my time among the wealthy. Are they have all the time in the world? No, they don't. Are they happy? They're miserable. They are miserable. I mean, they have this $150,000 car. I just got this $150,000 car. I'm going to drive it today. Yeah, but you know this. I got to do this. This isn't right. There's so much stuff on it. I got to deal with this. And they're moping around. I said, what's the matter? I said, it's a glorious day. I said, I'm retired. You know, I'm super wealthy. Life sucks. Life sucks. And for me, I'm this super lowly menial task person. And for me, I'm saying, oh my God, the day is so glorious. The peace of God imperceptibly dawned upon me today. Okay, because I got back to my spiritual habits. I realized, hey, we've been lied to say the least. We've been swindled by the reptilian, technician, scientific, you know, materialistic, affluent culture, the belief in that. We've been swindled by our bias against certainty in a big way. Now, some Americans, who the old money, you know, they underplay it all. They have a nice little house on in a country club somewhere. They spend a lot of time there, quiet time. They might go out and just play golf in quiet, real peaceful, quiet surroundings, and they live a modest lifestyle. But they have, you know, a lot of money in the bank, and they're not worried about money and stuff. So there's that. I'm not in that class at all. So they have, you know, the stocks and the bonds and the retirement money and all that stuff. That's sort of an older style of affluence that Americans built up, that sort of affluence. But the modern affluence is like Shark Tank, kind of Shark Tank like thing. People don't even have time for golf anymore. And if they do, it's go, 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 go. Drink, 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 drink. I mean, they're still like frazzled. Everybody's frazzled. Again, I work with, you know, very super wealthy people. And they are just frazzled. I mean, they're just so stressed out and frazzled and trying to live the good life. And it's just killing them. And they're literally melting down and freaking out and becoming tyrants, you know. It's just like, my God, waving their arms, you know. Just like, I want this and this, but we didn't get it done, you know, on time. And how come this happened like that? Why, you know? And they're just so struggling to find the answer, you know. Is it this color is the answer? Or maybe this pattern is the answer? Or maybe, you know, something in affluence for them has got to be the answer, they think. And it never is. It never is. And then the maintenance. All the maintenance is crushing them. People I know moved out of their, you know, super, super nice, beautiful house and the state and everything. They said, the maintenance is killing us. We're just going to live in an apartment now. They're smart. They said, you know, man, it's too much. We just cannot handle this. You know, we want to have some life for ourselves instead of just trying to maintain all this affluence. It's a vicious thing, affluence, vicious, and the people are caught up in it. They're screaming, and everybody is going into that meat grinder. Actually, it's interesting the life I've led to be around all these super affluent people, doing, you know, a bunch of menial stuff for them, and realizing how miserable they are. This helps me out in my spiritual understanding of how an austere society is vastly superior for everyone. Vastly superior. Because these people are just hating life. You know, they're on so many prescription medications. Just, they're not finding what they want at all. You know, they're obsessed with wine. You know, the life becomes consumed by wine. Like, are they getting the right wine? Are they serving the right wine? Are they having their friends over? Are having the right wine? And are you, you know, and they become just utterly obsessed by wine. And they think maybe that's it. Maybe having the right wine with the right food, that's it. Then a million problems, and then they're, you know, my water heater just broke. My dishwasher just broke. Everything just broke. Because it's junk. Everything's junk now. Oh my God, I've got to get it fixed, and I've got to go on a vacation, I've got to schedule this, and I got to, the scheduling never ends. the writing checks and everything. I mean, they, it's like, I got to write you another check. I know this one guy, all he does is, he writes checks. He says, man, I mean, do I have time for anything else in my life? I just writing checks, pretty much. So they got tons of money, but the affluence, they're trying to have an affluent lifestyle, takes so much, people helping them out. They're just, always writing checks, getting checks to people, checks, it's like, oh my God, it's like, I just want to get away from it. I just want to get away from it. Can I get away from it all? No, they can't. The grave to them is something like they're looking forward to the grave at some point, actually. I'm not looking forward to the grave because for me, the peace of God is imperceptibly dawning upon me. And everything looks beautiful, equally beautiful. And I noticed when I was driving around, I didn't fixate on anything. I didn't fixate on anything. I didn't say, oh, look at that beautiful rose or something. No, I was just feeling this overall feeling that's everywhere. So I was really interesting. I didn't try to single anything out. It was all beautiful. It was all beautiful. It was all this soft gentleness was everywhere. If you look at Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, her attention didn't fixate. They'd hand her some beautiful flower, and I noticed this. Whatever they give her, she'd go, But she never lost this awareness that everything is equally beautiful. I noticed she never fixated on anything. You get this feeling she's totally non-fixated, totally non-fixated. This is God, this is awareness of God. It's awareness of God. So I experienced that today. There's no desire on my part to fixate on anything. Whereas these affluent people, they're constantly fixated. What kind of title am I going to get? It's all important, all consuming, all consuming. Did I make the right choice? And the problem is they walk into a tile store a year later and they freak out. They say, oh my God. The stuff now is way better than what I got. I can't stand this. This is horrible. I want to redo the bathroom again. Well, we just did it. I know, I've been out, but I hate the tile. I get depressed when I see it. But it just cost us, $50,000. What are you talking about? No. I'm really depressed. My life, and I think it's the tile in the bathroom tile. Every morning I get up, take a shower. Yeah, but it made you happy over the last year. Yeah, I know, but it just doesn't do it for me anymore. I mean, I gotta get new tile. And I'm, I, or okay, no, that's okay. No, okay, no. I understand. It's expensive. If we don't have the money, that's okay. It's cool. Okay, I understand. And then the next thing you do, what they do? They go to their doctor and they start taking prescription anxiety medication, antidepressant medication. And then they don't even tell the husband. And then later on, they start drinking. And one day, they're like have a nervous breakdown is what happens, and the husband says, "My God, what's going on with you? What happened? I don't understand." And so I'm on antidepressants, and I've had a nervous breakdown, and I'm just feeling horrible, and the husband sees that she's just going to pieces. He says, "This beautiful, gracious, affluent, trophy wife is like, you can see she's going down the toilet." And then he says, oh my God, this is horrible. And he says, what can I do? What can I do? What can I do? What can I do for you? I'll do anything for you. And she goes, well, I don't know what I can do. My life just sucks so bad, but if I could just get up in the morning and take a shower for once and just like the bathroom just like made me feel alive and like, dignified again. It just makes such a difference in my life. And the husband says, okay, we'll remodel the bathroom. Okay, let's just done it. I've got to do it, Boom, she gets her way. She gets her way. This is how it works, actually. This is how affluence works. You may not think so, but the women who have money, that kind of affluence, they absolutely do this kind of stuff. They will play the game of I'm dying to get a change in their bathroom tile. Absolutely. They're willing to go to the mat for it, and they do. And this is spreading throughout the entire world. Women will do. They will feign, ruination in order to get the husband to, cough up, to work harder, to cough up more money, to get the changes because they walked into a tile store and saw that the patterns had changed. Whereas before, the patterns, you could get like patterns for your house that would last 10, 15, 20 years. Things didn't change so fast. And then maybe in 20 years, the woman would say, you know, we kind of need some new furniture. It's kind of outdated. But some of them said, no, I'm happy with it. And lucky husband, right? I go into a house recently where it was like the 70s, and they were happy with it. It was very nicely done, you know, really. And that's pretty cool, right? But most, you know, said, no, I got to update it. Now the updates are like every year. So it's killing the women. It's killing them. It's really killing. They can't handle it. Because they can't stand to think that someone else might, you know, have a more affluent house than them. Whereas before, you live in the suburbs, middle class suburbs, everybody kept pretty much the same house because they couldn't afford to remodel. And so the women were much happier. They were much happier and much wiser because of it. The less affluence you have in your neighborhood, the happier you're going to be, because the husbands were much happier too. They could actually retire. They could actually have a life instead of just trying to make, you know, the next million to keep up with the demands for affluence. So the world's going to hell. The world's going to hell in this way. And the ideal of a little suburban existence in a nice little modest house where you really are not going to remodel for the rest of your life. I mean, you're just going to keep it for 60 years, pretty much. So you might do a few little things, okay. You know, maybe some wallpaper at some point, you know. Yeah, a few things, fine. But let the husband have a life, okay? Don't turn him into a, you know, affluence object. You know, a slave, essentially. Don't turn him into an affluent slave. And then, guess what? The kids are happier. Because mom and the women help raise the kids. The husband is happy. He's home a lot. They do things together in a relaxed way. They're not trying to constantly, you know, be in this affluence competition. This is the ideal that we're supposed to get in the suburbs, and this is what I thought I was getting. And for the most part, I got it. But I was just happy for things just remain exactly the way they've always been. But it didn't quite turn out that way. And these days, like cars, it's just insane, right? I mean, I thought you get a car and you keep it for at least 20 years. Preferably 30, actually. We have a car that's about, what, 26 years old? Still runs great. Actually, I tried to start a couple days ago. It wouldn't start. So maybe that's it. I don't know. But the idea is you have the same car for maybe 20 or 30 years. These days, with leasing, people change their cars every couple years, actually, now. Every couple years. Here, every 2 years. You do not see an old car in the Bay Area. Hardly do you ever see an old car. Hardly ever. They're almost all, you know, 1 to 2 to 3 years old, and that's it. So, everything's that way. And all the appliances keep breaking. Everything only lasts a couple years now. What does that do to the wage earners? It turns them into slaves. Turns them into slaves, plain and simple. There's no time for the spiritual path under these circumstances. So I don't care what anybody says in the world, anyone posturing and posing like they're, you know, wise in a non-dual way. The world is going to hell, okay, no matter what they say. This whole economic structure we have of affluence and the way that it's set up, and the even worse structure of a Marxist structure of, you know, let's make everyone equally affluent kind of thing. And so it's managed, you know, the whole thing of let's regulate everything. You know, that's has its own terrors, actually. Because we've tried it. Everybody is spying on everybody else. Everybody's spying on everybody else. The best way is a religious culture based on austerity and housing. And you have to have religious-based housing based around churches and synagogues, temples, and ashrams, etc. Where The rules for remodeling flow from the church hierarchy. They really should be coming from there, based on See, Marxism is atheistic. It doesn't believe in God. It believes in building a social, affluent utopia. It's just capitalism and socialism are two sides of the same coin. They both believe that happiness comes from material affluence. It's just they want to be, socialists want to be sure that everybody is caught up in the affluence game. Whereas in capitalism, there's ones at the top are super affluent and the rest of us aren't so much. That's actually better. It's actually better. Capitalism is better than socialism, actually, because it leaves a lot of us not so affluent, which is great. Which is great. I'm loving my non-affluent life. Whereas socialism wants to make everybody affluent, which is horrible, because they don't believe in God. So that's why I support conservatism and support Trump to some extent in terms of, you know, yeah, he's Mr. Affluence, right? Yeah. Okay. So he wants a bunch of fat cat, rich, you know, Republican business people, right? Fine. Let them have their nice golf courses. So what? And does that mean that maybe, you know, I won't have it? And they say, okay, fine. That's okay. I want austerity anyway for the masses. So let the royalty be rich and let the rest of us be austere. Okay, I'm fine with that. I'm fine with that. That's way, way better than socialism. I don't have a problem with the rich. I really don't. The way things are, that actually works out for the best. Let a few people be big shots. Let them have billions of dollars. And let the rest of us be, you know, austere. Let the rest of us be austere and stop thinking that we can, you know, join their ranks, really. Capitalism is all rigged, you know, pretty much so, right? It's for the rich, of course it is. I mean, yeah, of course. So, you know, the criticisms are accurate, but so what? It's better for us. It's better for us. I don't have a problem with the rich. I'm around the rich all the time. They are nice and civil to me. Shake my hand, talk with me and stuff. They're okay. They're not ogres at all. They're not ogres at all. They just like being rich. They like making money. But that means that helps the rest of us be more austere. You know, be blue-collar, middle-class, austere. Keep the same car for 20, 30 years. Keep the same decor for 30 years. Same decor in your house. You got the furniture, the wallpaper, the curtains. Keep the same decor. Keep your same kitchen. I mean, we had the same kitchen for 40 years. Pretty much everything was the same for about 40 years, I would say, in our house. And finally, you know, we realized, well, we got to get out of the 60s or the 70s. You know, the 70s decor, the colors. You know, the rust colors, the rusty olive green, the rusty orange, the kind of dark yellow, and, you know, that kind of stuff. Okay, you know, it was the real dark, you know, cabinets and formica stuff. But me, I said, okay, you just leave it the same, because I don't pay any attention to it anyway. I'm just studying spiritual teachings. So it's kind of like a monastery. You don't change the decor of a monastery, right? It's the same for hundreds of years. Churches are supposed to be, you go there and you realize it's been the same way for 100 years, maybe 1,000 years. You don't remodel. So that's why, you know, church culture, religious culture is so effective. It's so helpful. It's so helpful. Keeps us out of the jaws of affluence, which is horrible. And why, you know, throughout historically the church and the rich people have gotten along is because the wisdom of religion realizes this is better. Let there's certain people that just have this, the person, their structure is just success, okay? Just success. So let them be successful. It's a curse for them, but they can handle it better than most. What's really bad is the nouveau riche here, where in Silicon Valley, where these people are just getting money thrown at them. They just, you know, make just massive amounts of money, but they're just these tech nerds or something, and it just wipes them out. They can't handle it. They can't handle it. Where there's these other people who it's just they're just born to be really successful. They can't miss as far as making massive amounts of money, and they can handle it a lot better. They can handle it. So let those who can handle wealth, like Trump, he can handle wealth. Okay, let him be wealthy. Let him handle the wealth. It doesn't mess him up that bad. For the rest of us, we don't want to be wealthy. It will mess us up really bad, really bad. We'll become monsters, actually, monsters. A lot of these wealthy women now who are just poor, they were austere and poor. They came to Silicon Valley, they were part of a startup, and now they're, you know, have multiple millions. They have so much money. They turn into monsters. They turn into in drug addicts and monsters. They can't handle it. They cannot handle it. I hear these stories all the time. Women just cannot handle this, who come from austere backgrounds. So let the aristocracy be the aristocracy, okay? And the rest of us, let us get down to the business of austerity, which is working on our bias against certainty and allowing the peace of God to imperceptibly dawn upon us, which I promise you it will. It absolutely will. It's dawning upon me now. It's dawning. It's very, very close. Very thin mist there. Very thin mist in my mind. I'm aware that it's very, very close. This morning it stayed with me, you know, all morning long. And I knew that it would probably diminish a little bit. A little bit of mist would arise. So I said, okay, you know, nothing I can do about it. Don't let me struggle with it. Just let me just wow this and just get used to it. So, and amazing enough, some of the aristocracy can even get this too. They just have this knack for wealth and power and stuff. That doesn't preclude them from the peace of God to imperceptibly dawn upon them. As long as they spend a lot of time working at it, like we do, you know. Which some of them can do. Some really aristocratic people are very beautiful people, actually. Very beautiful. Ananda Mahima treated them the same as anyone else, spent a lot of time with the Indian aristocracy. A lot of time. They supported her vastly. Vastly supported her. I mean, they did all sorts of things to enrich the lives of the people. Some of the Nawab, some of the Maharajas and Maharanis spent huge their fortunes. They spent a lot of their fortune, you know, big amounts of money, arranging tours for her around their states, so everybody could see Sri Sri Ananda Mahima and meet her. You know, you talk about, you know, doing great things with your money. That's doing something really, really great, because they realized that religion is greater. I mean, religion gave them the space to do what they do and didn't try to demonize them, and they understood that, and in the turn they patronized religion and said, you know, look, we support the saints, and we support the saints being among the people, and we put our money and our capability and those who serve under us at the disposal, and you want this temple, here's the temple, you know, you want this church built, here's the church. Like that. They just pay for it like that. That's how it's supposed to be. Now, most of the money of the rich people is just going to hate groups, to fund hate groups. It's pretty much all it's doing. And then they got charity, yeah, of course. They try to assuage their conscience, like, yeah, we're funding all these hate groups. And, you know, we're making sure that children with, you know, cleft lips, you know, get some surgery, yeah. And here's my dog, you know. We have three lovely dogs, so don't criticize us. Most of the saints came out of austere situations. Some came out of aristocracy. Some. They can come out of any class, actually, but most came from austere backgrounds. Now we know why. So there's nothing wrong with if somebody has just a true, they're just a true money magnet. You know, it's just how they are. There's nothing wrong with that person. They're not evil. There's nothing wrong with spending time with them. Like, I'd play golf with them. Sure, why not? And you know what? They love the peaceful surroundings and the quiet and the calm and the serenity. And they want to be, they want the peace of God to dawn upon them too. They really do. They just happen to be a money magnet. They can't help it. You know, it's just some people are that way. They really are. They just see opportunity everywhere. It's like second nature to them. Some of the capitalists are that way. And they're just, but they too, they crave it because, you know, the busy business life, you know, they just say, my God, I need peace in my life, you know. I get tired of money. They get tired of money. They really do. But the nouveau riche, who are calling the shots these days, they're really problematical. They're messed up, very messed up. They do not understand the noblesse oblige, the obligation of the nobility. See, the nobility understand the obligations, the religious, spiritual obligations that they have. The nouveau riche, they don't understand. Oh, they're just pigs. You know, they're just pigs. Affluence pigs. That's all they are. And they're desperately trying to pose, you know, I get it. No, they don't get it at all. There's some aristocracy's been at it for thousands of years. The Nawabs of Dhaka, you know, talk about a great nobility. The Nawabs of Dhaka were super patrons of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. In religion in general, they were fabulous, and they were beautiful people. They were very helpful people, most of them. You know, they're different, just like everybody has different qualities and characteristics. Some of them were great artists, they were, you know, really helped enhance religious culture. Anandamayi Ma became known to the world in living in the gardens, Shahbagh Gardens, which was the Nawab Pirabani, which was the wife of the Nawab of Dhaka. I think it was his wife or his daughter. Maybe it was his daughter, the daughter of the Nawab Maharaja Maharani, the Nawabs of Dhaka. I think it might have been their daughter, Pirubani. Something like that. And there was her gardens. They gave her this beautiful, one of the most beautiful gardens in the world, Shahbagh Gardens in Dhaka. And it was, she went there with her friends, women only were allowed there, just to relax and peaceful in this peaceful garden and to just feel the beauty, you know, the beauty of it. And she was very spiritual. And what happened was, they needed a superintendent of gardeners. Of course, they had to have all these gardeners to keep the estate up. So Anandamayi Ma's husband, Bholanath, was hired for that position of supervisor of gardeners there. And so then they had this little house there on the estate. It was a walled estate. It was all walled. Nobody could get in except through these gates. And so what happened was, the Pirubani began to meet Anandamayi Ma, and then she said, wow, this is so extraordinary. And she started inviting her friends in to come see her. So then all these very affluent women began to come see Sri Anandamayi Ma. Well, you might say, you know, aristocratic women are noble women, very highly placed in culture, very highly placed in culture. Not nouveau riche, but you know, they had, you know, patrons of spiritual culture began to come see her. And ultimately what happened was they began to bring their husbands, and they had to get permission from Pirubani for this. And then she gave permission for men to start being able to come inside the Shahbagh Gardens, whereas previously men were not allowed in there except for Bholanath and the gardeners, etc. That's it. So Anandamayi Ma said yes and allowed these very distinguished men to come start seeing her. But these men were very distinguished, you know, old school noble family, very, very cultured, genteel, spiritual men were, you know, allowed to come in. That's how it all started, pretty much, as far as her becoming known. And then ultimately, they invited her to their houses outside of Shahbagh, and that's how she began leaving Shahbagh Gardens. Before, she never left the gardens, the estate. She just lived in there and walked around in this, you know, one of the most beautiful gardens in the world, with fountains and lakes and canals and fruiting trees of every kind of variety, botanical flowers of every variety around the world. It was like a paradise. It was like just a gorgeous, gorgeous, super old trees, you know, just one of the most beautiful places in the world. And she just spent all her time there by herself most of the time, with some of her women friends come to visit her, just walking around, doing household chores, and living a very super austere life there. And then they began inviting her to visit their homes of these, you know, top judges, top doctors, top artists, top cultural people, top government people, you know, top aristocratic people. So she actually started then visiting them in their homes. And then the people, of course, just fell in love with her. Just said, oh my gosh, you know, this is just unbelievable. And she would walk up and down the street, and people would see her, and she started going to the Kali, a temple in Dhaka outside of Shahbagh Gardens. It was quite a walk. Siddhiswari is called, and some sort of Hindu temple there, ancient one. And so she had to walk through the city to get there. And as she'd walk through the city, everybody would come out, you know, to greet her, and she would heal people. As she walked through the city, she would just heal people right and left of all sorts of afflictions. Anything they asked for, she would just grant them. And then her fame began spreading all over the city. And people were just, you know, mad to come see her. And eventually it became, you know, such a scene that she left Dhaka. She left. There's other reasons why for her leaving, because she was aware that the partitioning was coming up into, you know, it would be now called, you know, East Pakistan. And the Hindus were going to be, you know, persecuted very severely. A lot of them, so she was aware that it was going to happen. So she shifted her center into northwestern India, Gangetic Plain, around, you know, Kashi, Benares, Varanasi, you can call it, and Delhi, and you know, all these various cities in more northern India, northwestern India. And she traveled around other places. So she moved her devotees out of East Bengal. Really, she helped move them out of there. But before that, she was like the queen of Dhaka. I mean, she was just the absolute top of the toppermost. I mean, the aristocracy just, you know, prostrated themselves before her, and rightfully so. They knew God when they saw God. You know, they knew one whose awareness never left God. You know, they knew that that's what she was, and they said, we sit in the dust before your feet. And they literally did. You get these top aristocrats dressing, you know, in commoner's clothes, sitting in the dust at her feet, bowing at her feet, you know, offering her all their riches. Say, whatever you want, it's yours. Whatever I have is yours. Do whatever you want with it, because they trusted her, rightfully so, of course. That's a real culture right there. That's a genuine culture. No wonder why she came into the world in such a place. The people who speak ill of religion, they're so ignorant. They're so unbelievably ignorant. They have programmed ignorance, you know, willful ignorance. Willful ignorance. You get so much virulent to attempt to annihilate religion, and they're so, so extremely ignorant. Willful, capricious, absurdist ignorance, you know, of how it's really been throughout history. They don't know their history at all. They're just programmed. They just, whatever materialism tells them to think, they're like robots. They just repeat it like robots, like it's some kind of code, software code that they've gotten. And then they project that roboticism onto religion and claim religion is the one that's coded roboticism, where it's, you know, totally the opposite, totally the opposite. The aristocracy's done a lot of great things throughout history, supported religion very strongly in many, many places. Wealthy people have. And all this Marxist classism, you know, they want to destroy that. They don't want religion to be funded at all. They don't want religion to be funded at all. They're afraid that someone like some billionaire might say, you know, say, hey, you know, I want to fund the building of, you know, 500 synagogues or something, or churches, or temples, or whatever, right? Or I want to fund this. I want to fund religious education for children. They're terrified of that. They're terrified of it. They want all power for the state, you see. They don't want any of these maverick, wealthy people saying, hey, here, Ananimaima, here's $1 billion. I want to make it possible for, like, you know, 100 million people to come see you. And I'm going to pay for their transportation to come see you. They don't want that at all. They want technocrats making every decision for every one of us. So they can say, no, we're not going to fund that. That's not allowed under our bureaucratic rules. We can't have a religion being funded by the state at all. And so they want all the money in hands of the state, and then say the religion has to be separate from the state. So basically no funding for religion whatsoever is what their ultimate goal is. It absolutely is. Look at communism, Marxism, they have tried to destroy all funding for religion. They want it wiped out. And so, of course, they want to have wealthy people wiped out, because you never know what these wealthy people who could think for themselves might do. They might say, hey, you know what? I have some land for you. I want an ashram. And here's 1,000 acres and the money to build a beautiful ashram. And I will pay for the maintenance of it. So if you saint will come live in this ashram and bless it with your presence, I will fund this. That's how it's been throughout history. Saints get funded by wealthy people, and the Marxists, the radical left Marxists, which the Democrat Party of the United States has been termited, infiltrated, and taken over by radical Marxists actually, and they want to absolutely destroy that. They don't want that to ever happen. They want to be the ones who decide how money is used for everybody, and they want to make sure it's not ever used for religion, for religious purposes, because, you know, of their own terror of God, you know, their great bias against certainty. They're very rebellious still. The rebellion against God, the familiarity with doubt, is causing them severe problems. And they're not able to get with religion yet. They can't even start it yet. They're super biased against it. Super, super biased. And so when you're super biased against religion, there's nowhere else to go except affluence. Materialism, there's nowhere else to go. So materialists have a very severe bias against God, against certainty. And so they want to be protected. They think they're threatened by, you know, God. Their attraction to God, they feel, is a threat, trying to annihilate them. So they want to make sure to get rid of that threat, and to do that they want all money in their hands as this bureaucracy. So they make sure that religion is not funded at all. They wipe out all 10 phases of religion that take you eventually to where the peace of God imperceptibly dawns upon you and stays with you all the days of your life. That's their goal. That's the goal of Marxism. It's the goal of communism. So the so-called inequalities of capitalism actually can help us more than they hurt, actually, because again, to be blue-collar, to be austere, is very, very helpful. Very, very helpful. You keep the house, the car, everything the same, and you have time to spend, you know, 5 hours a night in spiritual practice. I mean, I spend, once I come home from work at 4 to 5 o'clock, I spend the next, you know, 7 hours totally focused on spiritual, high spiritual stuff. 7 hours a day, at least, but I spend all the time I'm working, I'm focused on it also, but not quite as strongly as before. And in weekends, I spend all weekends focused on it. I say, hey, you know, let affluence, I'm not going to try to upgrade this. I tried that and it wiped me out. It's terrible. I'll spend the whole weekend 100% on spiritual focus. I'll do spiritual practice. I'll lay in bed till, you know, 11 in the morning because I'm doing 6 hours, straight hours of spiritual practice. Because I'm not trying to, you know, be affluent. I look for stuff like on clearance. I found all these shirts on clearance. I snatched them all up. That was a big expenditure. But I can wear those for the next, you know, hopefully 5 to 10 years. I don't need anything else really. I get a few things, presents, birthday presents and stuff, like people get for birth, you know, might get a jacket for my birthday or for Christmas or something, but that's, you know, and then I look for stuff on super clearance, real cheap, or on eBay, something used, and just do that, and then spend the rest of your time totally focused on high spiritual teaching. And guess what? The peace of God will imperceptibly dawn upon you as it's dawning upon me. That's the goal. And the goal is very reachable in a spiritual culture. So, you know, that's why I have the focus. I'm pro aristocracy, pro business, pro wealthy people, in terms of let them do what they do best and let the rest of us be austere. Okay, because that spiritually, that's what works. And the Marxist ideal is a disaster for spirituality, and it's killing the world. It's killing the world. They think they're saving the world. They're killing it. The world doesn't want to be host to materialists, really. Not really. Not that the world there exists. There really is no world. But what they're doing is they're valuing their death, is what they're doing. They're valuing death and sickness. They're valuing death and sickness. So, you know, the world loving to kill us, which is how the world feels, because that's what we've projected upon it. We love to kill ourselves. And that's what Marxists and communists love. Okay, that's what they love. There's no hope there except this horrible grind of affluence. This horrible grind of affluence. They want to train everybody in affluence. They want these poor third world people who are so blessed. This is some of the best people in the world are third world people, poor third world people. I meet them every day. I work side by side with them. I had this man help me today. He's so poor. He's so uneducated. And yet he helped me so beautifully. He helped me. I had to carry all this heavy stuff. I had all this heavy work I had to do. And he just quietly, without saying a word, just went to work doing exactly what I needed. He's just a laborer. He's a slave laborer. Okay. And he just helped me out with all the heavy work today. And I said goodbye to him. We just looked in my eyes. He just looked directly in my eyes. Directly. I looked in his eyes. I said, I appreciate it, man. I really helped. Thank you so much. I get all these very poor, bottom of the barrel, slave-like people help where I work with them, and they help me. And they're wonderful people. They haven't been corrupted by affluence. They're able to be simple and quiet. They eat a simple meal for lunch and then get back to, you know, busting rocks. Yeah. Carrying heavy wheelbarrow loads all day, you know, and I just spend time talking with them and hanging out with them. And I'm just appreciating them. You know, they're the first ones to jump up and help you. You know, the wealthy people, they don't lift a finger to help you. I mean, well, the ones who are, there's some blue-collar people help one another out. But professional people, no, I'm above that and I don't do that stuff. You know, you're beneath, you're lower. You know, you have to do that heavy meal. But it's the poorest people that jump up the first to help me. This is what I've noticed. And they're the kindest, and their spirits are bubble, are laughter, and they see, they're wise, you know. They look at things, and you can talk with them, and they see so much. They say, you know, this, I see this. So that's not for me. That's not for me. So they have this austerity, generations and generations of austerity. They've lived it. They've not had any. Affluence at all, going back hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, these people I work with, and they're such beautiful people and very wise. They don't need an education to be very wise. They see what needs to be done and they just do it, and they're really not interested, that interest in austerity, but pretty quickly, austerity corrupts their children, unfortunately. It corrupts their children. They lament their children here in the United States. They lament them. They say, I have no control over my children at all. All they're into is affluence, and I don't understand them at all. They don't understand me at all. And they're just so kind of depressed about it, actually. They said, wow, what's the world coming to? What is the world coming to? They can't discipline their children. They can't teach them their children austerity at all. It's against the law to teach austerity here in the United States now. It's against the law. You cannot discipline your children. You can't say, hey, you can't even take them to work with you and say, hey, start doing some work, start working. Child abuse, you know. No, they got to be in school. The Marxists have to educate them. You have to have common core of Marxism educating all your children. Say, no, you're above that. You don't have to do that stuff. I talked to this cleaning lady today. You know, I said, how are you? How's your day going? You know, I just spoke with her like she's this lowest, you know, just slaving all day, cleaning rich people's homes. And I treated her just like she's my sister, you know. I don't see, because I was in God, the peace of God was upon me today. And I don't see any difference. She's my sister. And so I treated her like, I said, how are you today? She looked at me and she goes, man, I'm just working so hard. The work is so hard. You know, that's what it is for me today. I said, yeah, well, thank God it's Friday. Well, she's probably working that hard Saturday too, you know, and Sunday. But she had a beautiful smile, you know, and she shrugged and sighed and says, you know, what can I do, you know? But a lot of these, the shrewd ones, who come from austere backgrounds, they become caretakers of the rich, these rich, real rich people, and they become very affluent. They're able to send their children to private schools, because these really super wealthy people, they can't live without their maid, their caretakers, or you know, their live-in maids. I asked this one woman. I said, you working here? She goes, yeah. I said, how often do you work? She says, every day. I'm here every single day. I take care of everything for them. Said, and this is very common. And sometimes the children, actually, of these immigrants, they work to take care of the children of these super rich people. And they become indispensable. And they buy them cars. They make sure that their children get good education. And they become affluent, actually. This is their road to affluence, is becoming these... And they're driving these like brand new, like super SUVs. And they just came here, you know, 10 years ago or something. And so they tap the money tree of these, you know, people, $100 million or how much they have, $50 million. I mean, they're very wealthy people here. And you know, they end up becoming the nouveau riche that way. And their children become very affluent. They have all the toys, the computers, everything. And so the children, the idea of them doing this hard work, no way in the world will they do it. No way will they do it. And if they don't, the children don't get that affluence, the way that schools raise them, they think that's beneath them, so they refuse to do that work, and then they become gangsters. They get in gangs and drugs and stuff. They don't want to work hard like the way their parents did. I mean, their parents work really hard. Really hard. You know, it's blue collar, lower class, lower blue collar labor, you know, labor stuff. And maids and labor, and they won't do it. They won't do it. They'd rather just hang out and make money off selling drugs, actually. That's what they do. Once you get a college education, you know, but they don't have the entitlement complex that most Americans have. Generations have it getting an entitlement complex. You can't compete, because what universities really teach you is an entitlement complex. And these people who come from these very austere background with their grandparents, parents, grandparents, great grandparents, very austere, very poor. Once they get to the university education, they say, oh, I can't be that way anymore. And yet, still, their habits are not entitlement habits. So they can't compete with, you know, Americans. They can't compete. And then they get stuck in this middle ground and you know, they can go bad, go to crime. A lot of them go to crime, actually. A lot of crime is what happens. Because a lot of culture is entitlement, okay? And it's just obvious to see. You see people, even though they're not nearly as smart as you, if they've been trained in how to project entitlement, they're going to get their way. They're going to get their way. You know those people. They get into management positions. They tell everybody else what to do because they want the money, they want the affluence. And they may not be nearly as capable as you are, but they've got this entitlement thing down. They're willing to just act like they're entitled to it. They have the right friends, they're also entitled, they went to the right schools, and so, you know, this is entitlement culture of the, you know, upper middle class entitlement culture. Which is not a good thing. A hereditary aristocracy is better, in my opinion, is you're just born into it, and you're taught your obligations, and you don't have to struggle and compete against everybody to be that way, so you can be actually a nice person. The nouveau riche here are sharks. They're just sharks. The sharks get to the top. But as an aristocracy, that's not necessary. You don't have to be a shark. A lot of the aristocracy became that way because they were great warriors and they won huge battles and they got all the land. They owned all the land then. And then they, you know, began taxing and administrating the land that they owned. And that's how aristocracies arose. Or some came out of, you know, bankers, merchants. Some aristocracies came out of that. But a lot of it was great warriors, great victories in battle. And So they owned the land, and then you were born into those families, and you just were trained in how to, you know, function that way. You didn't have to fight your way to the top anymore. Here, Silicon Valley, is everybody's trying to fight to the top, and people are just driving on sidewalks to get around you. If you're stopped at a traffic light, they'll go up on sidewalks. And literally drive on the sidewalk so they can get advantage of like five cars on you. So they can then make a right-hand turn at a light, red light, so they don't have to wait for like 1 minute. They don't have to wait for 1 minute. They will go up on sidewalks, dodging fire hydrants and telephone poles, just so they can, so they don't have to wait for 1 minute. And they feel they're entitled to do that. Recently, I said this before in another video, the people stopped at a red light, and they said, well, there's nobody, okay, I'll just go. And they stopped like a stop sign, and then they drove right through a red light. So I can't wait for this. I can't wait for a red light. I've got to, you know, I'm entitled to affluence. I'm entitled to affluence, and this red light's getting in my way. So sure, the Marxists hate aristocracy, because they want to be the aristocracy. But they're crass, you know, they're crass. They can't handle it. And they're paranoid, actually. Marxists are very paranoid of God. They don't want God in the world. Because they think they're greater than God. They say, no, we can run the world better than God. Those are Marxists. We can run the world better than God. The previous president was a Marxist, and he was that way. He felt he was smarter than God. That's true. It's very true. He went to Bethlehem, birthplace of Jesus. He was in the holy place himself. He ignored it. I mean, he was inside. He was chatting with people, and he didn't get down on his knees. He didn't pray. He acted like he was superior to Jesus. You know, he thinks he's a Marxist. He thinks he's superior to God. He says, I can run the world better. I know how to run the world better than God does. Better than the grace of God, actually. Those are Marxists. If I'm in the birthplace of Jesus, I'm on the ground. And I'm tuning into the silence. You know, I'm tuning into the gentle glory. And I'm asking Jesus to remove my doubt, you know, my bias against it. Remove my bias, Jesus, against the gentle glory of God. And by the way, thank God that you came into the world. And may the peace of God that I have, may that merit go to you. Okay, so you can distribute it, because you're a lot wiser than I am. You're a lot wiser than I am. So the Dharma kings are greatly wiser than any of us, okay? So dedicate the merit of your spiritual practice to the Dharma kings. Don't dedicate it to some Marxist, and not even to the aristocracy or the capitalists either. But they don't expect you to, okay? The Marxists expect you to. Dedicate it to God. Dedicate the merit of your practice to the Dharma kings, the agents of God, who wisely know how to structure culture so that will lead you ultimately, so you will experience the imperceptible dawning of the glory of God upon you, the peace, the gentle glory of God upon your mind. Because nothing less will ever satisfy you. Nothing less will ever satisfy you. Affluence will never satisfy you. Only seeing this gentle glory everywhere will satisfy you, because that's what you are. That's what is. That's reality. Everything else is just an attempt to doubt reality, and so you can pretend that you're greater than God and pretend that you rule the world and know how to administrate it properly without the help of God, you know. Go through that Marxist pretense, communist Marxist pretense. Most liberals are becoming Marxist. A lot of them are already Marxist, actually. And they're just trying to find some way to get God out of the picture. They hope non-dualism will do it, but it doesn't, not really. They want their non-dualists to be very dry. Yeah. Shaken, not stirred. I mean, they say, you can say this, you know, but don't talk about God, you know. Don't talk about the grace of God. Just say, you know, get some non-dual bromide. But they're very nervous when you start talking about the grace of God, actually. Just mentioning Jesus. They don't, you know, I put up all these Dharma King websites, video channels on YouTube. I wanted to see, you know, who is patronized, and you know who's the very lowest. And on all the posting I've done in my life, you know who's gotten the least response by far is Jesus Christ. The least response. That means the Marxists are most worried about Jesus. He's their nightmare. Ananda Mai Ma has got the most viewers, rightfully so, because we have pictures of her, and you cannot resist. You know, we lack pictures of Jesus, which is a big it's a big problem, because we just have the words. You know, we just have the words, and words aren't good enough. Words aren't good enough. The words aren't gonna. We've gotten clobbered by materialism, because we lack pictures and videos of Jesus. You know, we lack it. And now to my mom, we have these pictures, and you can, I look at the pictures and say, oh my God, that's what Jesus was like. That's what Buddha was like. That's what Longchenpa was like. That's what Bamasamba was like. Oh my God, this is amazing. We have pictures of Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodra. We have pictures of Rama Maharshi. This is super, super, super helpful for us. If not for that, I feel we would have been crushed. We would have been crushed. Yes, A Course in Miracles was helpful, but you know what really helped me out with it so much was Rama Maharshi and Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. Without their help, I wouldn't have gone as far as I've gone. Because Marxism was so severe in the world right now that it was causing me to try and stuff A Course in Miracles into Marxism, which many are trying to do. And it doesn't fit. Doesn't fit. Doesn't fit. It's not classist in that way, it doesn't fit that way. And it just doesn't fit. So or anti-classist, it just, whatever it is, it doesn't fit. So we don't have pictures of Jesus, so I don't have anything to give people. I'll say, look, this is Jesus in terms of what he put a face on Jesus and see that the peace of God is upon even his body, his countenance, his face. The gentle glory is upon his countenance, and you can't miss it. It's there. That's so important to see we're not the body by the fact that even though we believe we're the body, we can change our belief, and we don't have the body doesn't have to die for us to experience the gentle glory of God. We don't have we can still be here in the world. It's so important. And Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma proved to everybody that you can live 86 years here, interacting with millions of people as she did, and the gentle glory of God never left her for even an instant. And never even was diminished for even an instant. She proved it. Same with Rama Maharshi, he proved it. That's a powerful, powerful proof that we have here that offsets Marxism. It offsets it, cancels it out. It's more powerful than Marxism, actually. And a lot of these non-dual Marxists, they don't pay any attention to her. I've noticed that. A lot of non-dual teachers are really Marxist in wolves in sheep's clothing, you might say. They just hope to get a high position in Marxism because they're stuffing it into the non-dual teachings, trying to stuff it into Marxist ideology in some one way or the other. So let's keep the affluence, Let's keep the affluence for everybody. We'll have this nice non-dual teaching, and we'll all be happy. It's beyond non-duality. It's the imperceptible dawning of the gentle glory of God upon you, upon your mind. And you see that fact in Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, Rama Maharshi, Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro. You see that fact. It's a fact. You can see it. You can see it. It's unmistakable. You can see it. And you say, that's what it's really about. No matter what your rhetoric is. Now, non-dual rhetoric can be helpful if you take if it's put in the right context, you understand these are just words. These are just words. And you have to allow the imperceptible dawning of the gentle glory of God upon your mind, so you love everyone equally, so you see it everywhere. And that means you love Trump as much as you love the previous president. Okay? You love them both equally, as much as you love your neighbor, as much as you love the person you meet here and there, etc., etc., etc. But the idea that we can all have this love if we're all equally affluent is ridiculous. Marxism is completely ridiculous. This gentle glory is coming come comes from God, and that you see the spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness, everywhere. equally disposed everywhere. That's apex yoga, brings you to this realization. That's the realization you come. Okay, but you don't get that through a structuring of society, a Marxist structuring society at all. You get that through austerity and a lack, you know, austere culture with patronage from those who have the knack for wealth, of religion, etc. You get it through the old-fashioned ways. That's how you actually get it. That's how it succeeds. Now, people throughout history didn't necessarily have this non-dual teaching we have now, but they had right prayer. All you need is one thought to block all others, and the general glory of God will imperceptibly dawn upon you. That's all you need is apex yoga, actually. That's what Ramana Maharshi said. You only need this one practice. You just need one practice. And plenty of people throughout history have done this one practice. Christians did it. They didn't know anything about non-duality. Okay? But they actually experienced God as one. God is everywhere. The presence of God was upon them. It imperceptibly dawned upon them because they did right spiritual practice, right prayer. Right prayer is to hold on to one thought. I say, I am an apex yogin. Wow. That's how I practice. Hold on to that one thought to the exclusion of all others. Some Christians, I say, Mother Mary, pray for me, or Holy Jesus, cover me with your precious blood. Or they have their own phrases they say. But just say, that's fine. So if you want to pray the rosary to Mother Mary, that's fine. Just make sure that's all you pray. Just pray that one simple prayer. And repeat it, and repeat it, and repeat it, and repeat it, and block. This way it blocks all other thoughts. And what are thoughts? Thoughts are nothing but doubt. Thoughts are nothing but doubt. That's all they are. And so when you reduce all doubt to just this one simple doubt, then it's super easy to allow the imperceptible dawning of the general glory of God upon your mind. It's very easy then to just say, okay, I can set that aside. But when you have the play of doubt going along, then it blocks it. So when you just have one doubt and the whole play of doubt has ceased because you've only held on to this one doubt, this one thought, the whole play of doubt subsides. You let it all settle down. It's all about letting your attention, the play of doubt, settle down. Then, since there's no more play of doubt, it's not a problem at all that the general glory of God imperceptibly dawns upon you. Because it's not interfering with any play of doubt, you see, at that point. That's already all settled down. That's the entire key to it. And so you don't even, anybody can do this. They could just say, I am this pebble. Or you can be like, who was it? Bodhidharma, and stare at a wall for 10 years. You know, I'm just staring at this wall. What was he doing? He was just doing one thing and letting his action, that's the type of yoga where you just sit, all you do is sit quietly. You don't do anything. You're just staring at a wall. So he's blocking all action, the whole play of doubt. He was blocking it all by doing just one thing, nothing else. And once it had all settled down, then easy for the general glory of God to imperceptibly dawn upon him. Easy, you see. That's the whole secret to it. You could just, you could say, what would you say? I am a pineapple or something. Or just, this pineapple is beautiful. And that's all you say. This pineapple is beautiful. And if that was all you said, and you blocked every other thought from your mind, that would be equally effective. It really would be equally effective than saying, Om Mani Padme Om. It really would be. That's the apex yoga secret, the great secret. It's even above all tantric yoga, of mantra yoga, japa yoga. It's even above all of that. It's above all of it. That's Ramana Maharshi told us this. He helped bring this to our attention. He says, use one stick to stir all the other sticks in a fire so they're all reduced to ashes. And then in doing so, that stick that you use to stir all the other sticks will also be reduced to ashes. No more sticks. In other words, no more concepts. No more doubt. No more thought. No more doubt. He says, for sure, you will be the same as I am in terms of the general glory of God. You'll see it everywhere. For sure, he says. He says, that's the way. It's the only real way. That's the way. And anyone can do it. Anyone can do it. But if you're caught up in this frenzy of affluence, you're doubting everything. You're caught up in this play of doubt severely. Constantly trying to gain advantage. You know, how can I get, you know, my kitchen redone? How can I, you know, keep up with what my friends look like? Oh my God, my friends just got this Range Rover, the newest Range Rover. You know, oh my God, I got, you know, next year I got to make sure I trump them and get the 218, you know, or something, right? I mean, it's all about the bells and whistles, and it never ends. The bells and whistles never end. Once the whole culture becomes caught up in that, the whole flow of money gets caught up in that, we're doomed. We're doomed. As far, you know, we're going to live in hell is what we're headed for. We're going to be living in hell with no hope except that new car, you know, which I can tell you, it's nothing, you know. It's no different. It's really no different than the car that's 30 years old. It's just transportation to get somewhere. Yeah, you could say it's a little safer, fine, but it's, in terms of the buzz lasts a couple days. For me, it didn't even start. The buzz never really started. I hit the turbo, and that was fun for like about 3 seconds. And then, okay, turbo, car goes fast for a little bit. Okay, nice, whatever. We used to have, you know, 444s engines, and they went pretty fast too. 50 years ago, 40 years ago, we had some cars that also went pretty fast back then, but they didn't have all the bells and whistles these days where you start drifting out of your lane and, you know, steering wheel starts shaking, you start going off the road and steering correct, you know, I mean, pretty cars trying to drive for you now, smart cars. But the thrill, it's gone. Gone very soon. The thrill is like bragging to your friends, or you know, look at the car I got. Every time I tell my friends, they pay no attention. It's like, huh? I realize, hey, you know, God's just blocking that. You know, it's like you're bragging about your affluence, and they just like they're not in the slightest bit interested. Not in the slightest bit interested. So you don't even get that kick. You know, you can't even brag about it. And there's all the maintenance. You know, the birds parked it under a tree. Came out from a grocery store and the car is absolutely covered with bird poop. Just covered, you know. It's like, wow. I said, oh, it's a blessing. What a blessing. That means that the sky, what comes from the sky, birds represent from on high. You know, they're able to be on high at will, right? And so they're giving us offerings. Pooping on the car is giving all this offerings from the sky, sort of, really. From the birds, that's a great blessing. We're really going to be blessed. We're going to be greatly blessed. And then here it is, the peace of God imperceptibly dawns upon me. And that's the only real blessing that has value in this world. That's the only value you'll ever find in this world. That's it. Everything else should just be a means to get to this value. To get this value, get this treasure in your life. Everything else should just be the means to get this treasure. And if it's not working for you, get rid of it. Don't pay attention to it anymore. If it's not working for you, if watching television is not getting you to this great treasure, then stop watching television. If sports isn't getting you to it, then stop sports. If shopping isn't getting you to this, then stop shopping. It's not worth it. All you're getting is death. That's it. That's all you're going to get. You're going to get sickness and death because you believe that there's a place to be sick and a place to die when in fact there isn't. You're just hallucinating it, actually. Hallucinating the absence of reality. We think that hallucinating the absence of reality is some place, is some other place. It's not. It's not. So, Fortunate are those, I believe, who watch these videos and get the feel of all this. I may be, because people like me may be becoming extinct. I think they are virtually extinct right now, virtually extinct. Who can still live in an affluent culture of the world and yet still have the old values and have not lost them and been willing to put up with it and play the game, yet still, be a workaholic on the spiritual path. Thanks to the grace of God. Otherwise, I wouldn't have stood a chance. I wouldn't have a chance. If you don't have the grace of God, if you don't accept the grace of God in your life, you don't have a chance. Don't have a chance. And in order to accept the grace of God in your life, you have to realize you have a problem. And our problem is severe bias against certainty. And totally irrational, absurdist bias towards doubt. Believing that hallucinating the absence of reality is some place. Some other place, some other kingdom. That's what we literally believe. And we're so used to that. We have this extreme familiarity bias towards it. So we have a very severe problem, and we need the grace of God to free us from this problem, because we won't be freed in any other way. It's not my intellect that freed me. I mean, I'm a genius. My intellect's a genius level. But that's not what freed me at all. That's not what's led me to where I'm at, where the freedom is dawning upon me. It's the grace of God and nothing else. If without the grace of God, I'd be a monster, plain and simple. Anyone this smart would be a monster. I mean, I'd be filthy rich. I'd be a filthy rich monster. The bad kind, not the old rich. Yeah, I mean, I'd be a rock star, that kind of lifestyle or something. I'd be bad. I'd be a monster without the grace of God. So, grace of God saved me, and nothing else saved me. It wasn't my intellect that saved me. It wasn't how smart I am that saved me at all. I used that in the right way, but only because the grace of God showed me the right direction and freed me up to do so. Then I used my intelligence in the right way, and I'm using it in the right way to be able to converse and share this with you. I'm able to speak well and present well and all of that. But that's 100% because of the grace of God, 100%. So don't think that you or anybody can do it on your intelligence. You'll turn into a monster if you do that. And you'll breed other monsters, and you'll create a monster culture, a wicked culture, actually. You can give all the money in the world to philanthropy you want. You're still generating a very wicked culture. There's so many examples I don't need to say. It's just, I'm surrounded by it. That's the pattern of the world now. People try to help me. I'm so strong now. They go to help me. He said, "Need some help?" I said, "No, I got it. I'll carry this heavy stuff. I'll do this stuff. I'll do the slave labor. I'm strong enough to do this. I made sure that I'm trying to be strong enough so I can do the slave labor." Keeps you humble. So you don't think you can use your intellect to be happy, No. It's not your the only happiness there is in this world is the general glory of God imperceptibly dawning upon you. That's the only happiness there is. So you better remain humble so you don't think that you can get it some other way. Because if you think you could get it some other way, you're going to be a monster and you're going to dwell in hell. That's a fact. So be serious about it. Be serious. I'm really blessed. I'm blessed that I have a, humble occupation, and I have to do, humble work, and I have to stay strong, you know, or I'll get injured. Yeah, really, seriously, my core has to be strong. I learned something from a surf coach that I read on the internet. Engage your core. You have to engage your core. He says, engage your core, and it clicked for me. I never even realized that. You can intentionally engage your core, tighten your whole core, all the core muscles you have, tighten them up, and keep them sort of really locked and tight as you do something, and you won't injure yourself so badly if you know, if your core is strong, and you can be aware how strong your core is. Right now, my core is quite strong, and so I'm able to do stuff, and by intentionally engaging my core, I don't hurt myself. I used to injure myself all the time, and that's like engaging your faith. The core of spirituality is faith, so you have to keep your faith really strong. You have to keep faith is for all stages of the ladder of spiritual progress. You need faith all the way through. It's the key to keep you going, so you don't stall out. And you have to engage your faith. You have to engage your faith. And when you engage your faith, you will find you will go faster and faster and faster. Just like when you in your daily life, if you engage your core, you can do heavier work, lifting, twisting, doing all this heavy stuff, menial, you know, manual labor stuff. You can do it and not get injured. But you got to engage, be willing to engage your core. You can't play the weakling, you know, and say, oh, I'm trying to lift this with my hands and my arms, but oh, it hurts. No, you got to be the strong person and get that core engaged. All that whole trunk and core and your, you know, the abs and everything, get them engaged in what you're doing. Fully engaged. You got to be get fully engaged, all your muscles engaged. Don't say, oh, I don't want to really, you know, be that way. Don't be too genteel about it. So the spiritual path, you cannot be too genteel about your faith. You have to engage your faith. You have to engage your faith. You have to believe in miracles. You have to share miracles. Christian culture is supposed to share your spiritual path with other Christians and talk about the miracles that God has done for you and how faith has paid off for you. That's the Sangha in Buddhism. It's the Sangha. The body of Christ and the Sangha are the same thing. You're supposed to share this information to strengthen faith, because faith is the core which helps you climb that ladder all the way to the top, to the point where the general glory of God imperceptibly dawns upon you. Okay, to that point, and then you get used to that, you get more and more used to that. You have to engage your faith, or else you'll stall out. And then you become feeble and ultimately bitter. And then you drop out altogether and become a Marxist eventually. Yeah, you do. You become a liberation theologist, Marxist, you know, you do become that when you don't really engage your faith. And I try to engage my faith constantly, constantly. I just trust in the grace of God for everything. I mean, what else can I do? I have to do that. I just keep saying, look, everything's going to work out great, even though the future looks like a, you know, a blank wall. You know, it's just, how am I going to? I don't know, but I somehow God will get it done. I read something by a spiritual teacher today that said that. I think it was Sri Srinandamayama, could have been, but she said, if you give all of your efforts to realize God and discipline yourself, then don't worry about your life. She says, God will take care of your life for you. I promise you this. God will take care of your life for you. You know, you wonder, how can I survive if I really engage all my efforts to realizing God? And she says, God knows that what you're doing, and God will take care of your life. Don't worry about it. So I have faith in that. I have to have faith in that, because I can't keep up with the affluent society. You know, I'm headed for destitution. It seems that way. I can't pay all the fees. There's so many fees. The bureaucratic fees are just, you know, killing everybody. It's just crazy. Just to smog your car, smog the, you know, do this, do this requirement, this requirement, this requirement. They're just, you have to be wealthy just to be minimally keep up with it. So I say, how in the world, you know, registration, like $200, got to register $200, you know. What? It used to be like 15. I can't afford $200 to register a car, you know? I can't keep up. Can't keep up. So something has to happen. You know, I don't know what. When she says, "Well, God will take care of you," that all options are open. All options are open. I don't say how God can do this. If God wants to shift me to some other realm, I'm game for that too. Fine. Because I don't see how it's possible for those who aren't battling. I mean, the young people, they tell me that they hate it. They have to just battle one another. A man told me that he was chugging, you know, monster drinks, energy drinks, and he says, "I got to do it every day, all day." I said, "Why?" He says, I cannot miss class. I have to be on time. I have to be there. If I don't keep up, then I'm kicked out of class and something, because everybody, there's so many people waiting to get in." And he says, "The competition is just ruthless." And he says, "I have to use these monster drinks just to survive the competition." And he says, "I hate it. It's killing me." He says, "But if I don't do that, he says, I have to get this class in order to get the degree, and I have to get this degree in order to get the next degree, and I have to, you know," he says, "I'm on this ladder and I can't get off. And I know it's killing me, but what can I do?" I mean, a lot of young people know it's killing them. Doctors I talk with, they say that a lot of their patients are young people who have diseases of some old person. They're being killed by it, and they know it. They tell me, "This is killing me." Directly, they've told me this. They say, "I know this is killing me. I don't know if I'll, you know, how old I'm going to live. Will it be 40, 50? I don't know. Maybe not. I'll maybe be dead by 50, but I got no choice. I can't survive. I can't survive otherwise. I can't survive otherwise." So this is the society we have right now. You know, this is this wonderful society we have, this wonderful Marxist society that has told everybody that everyone's supposed to be affluent, and the proletariat is supposed to rise up and, you know, seize power from the capitalists so they can all be affluent too. So everyone thinks that they're supposed to be affluent, and there's something wrong with them if they're not. This is insanity. It's insanity. Whereas before, poverty was a virtue. In religious culture, poverty is a virtue, and people were honored to be poor. And they were held in great esteem. Those who were most austere were held in the highest esteem in religious culture. Just like saints. Look at Ram Maharshi. Nothing. Look at the veneration that he has, and rightfully so. He was the total austere yogin, you know, the most, the perfect example of it. The perfect example. And you see him, and he just shames us all. You know, he shames us all, but in a beautiful way. We say, "My God, if only I could be like that." And I want to be more like that, you know. Just King of Austerity, Ram Maharshi. Wow. So again, before, in religious societies, it's the most austere, those who are most morally strict and austere, who get the most praise and reverence and respect. And that becomes the ideal of society, becomes the ideal. That's religious culture. That's what we're supposed to be doing. That's what we're supposed to be doing. And it's virtually extinct. Virtually extinct now. I saw one woman came to Catholic Church, and I noticed right away that she was super austere. She's probably going to enter a nunnery or something. Her clothing, everything. She was completely out of fashion in every way. No makeup, no attention to her appearance at all. But she wasn't homeless or anything, but you could see she's on the edge of destitution, and just super austere, super poor, and yet super present. I said, "Wow. That's in old days, the right way, she would have been given great praise, you know, and people would have emulated that, and they would have given her great respect. But she got no attention at all. I might have been the only one in church who noticed her. You know, I said, wow, there's a real Catholic right there. There's your model right there. I wanted to say something to her, but I would have felt kind of too weird, you know, because our whole culture has gotten so weird, you can't even praise these people anymore. She's such an anomaly. You know, people say, oh, maybe she's homeless, maybe she's a drug addict, maybe she's... No, I didn't see that. I didn't see that. I just saw someone that was oblivious to her appearance because it wasn't important to her, you know, that getting God was important to her. That's how I saw it. That's how I saw it. And that's ultra, ultra rare right now. Whereas in the past, that was common. That was common. So you can see we're a fallen culture. We're a fallen world. We're a fallen world right now. We're very fallen. And what is God going to do about it? I don't know. Is he going to take those who want to, you know, want to pursue the grace of God, the glory of God, the gentle glory of God imperceptibly dawning upon their minds? Is God going to take them to another planet, another dwelling place? Very possible. That's what apparently the Bible says. Jesus said that. That's what is reported. He said, you could do that. He could do that. He could do it. And maybe he will. Maybe God will do this. Because this place right now is a very fallen world. And with this materialism, children now have all been raised on you know, smartphones with all this affluence constantly being pumped into their minds. I don't see how we can return this world culture to the way it's supposed to be. I don't see how that's possible. I really don't. I put up 300 pictures of Sri Sri Nandamayam on Facebook, and you know, the mania lasted about 3 days, and now people have gone back to their frantic pursuit of affluence. They're so frantically pursuing affluence, they can't even stop for 300 pictures of Sri Sri Nandamayam. If that can't stop them in their tracks, I don't know what can. I don't have anything that can, other than their actual presence of the Dharma Kings. That's the only other thing that could happen. And even that may not stop them in their tracks. It might. But that's the only card that can be played right now. That's the only card that can be played is the Dharma Kings appear in this world, physically appear in this world, actually. And that might stop some of us in our tracks. It might. And it might not. Other than that, go to another world. That's about it. That's about it. That's how I shift to another dimension, go to another world. So we've got about two more options left to play. I mean, I played one of them, her pictures, the greatest pictures in history right there. I just dumped on Facebook. Greatest pictures in history right there. Without a doubt. If that can't stop you in your tracks, you know, you're hardcore fallen. I mean, you can spend years just looking at one of those pictures. And it would be enough. You might be liberated just by doing that, actually. Because the grace there in those pictures is just so overwhelming. It's just like, you can breathe it. You can breathe it. The pictures are so sublime. She's so sublime, you can just breathe it. It's like enters, it just permeates you. It's so intense. These are the best pictures ever. Some of them are just, oh my gosh, it's just, oh my God, you know, you would say. I mean, only a few of her devotees, oh my God, you know, someone responded that way. That was the best response. Oh, OMG, oh my God. And she said, it's a miracle. This is a miracle. And she's right. One of my friends responded that way. Oh my God, this is a miracle. And she's absolutely right. It is a miracle that happened. Very wise, wise woman. And this is a miracle that happened. And yet, how many will be stopped in their tracks and turned away from the life of affluence, pursuing affluence? Maybe no one. Maybe no one. But hopefully those who are already austere can stay that way. I'm hoping that that can help them stay that way. That's my prayer. That's my prayer. That's why I did it. I hope they can just stay that way. You know, don't get lost in affluence. We don't have to make a, you know, we don't have to be an anomaly, social anomaly. We don't need to be in rags, okay? I mean, you don't want to be standing out like a sore thumb because that draws too much attention to yourself. But it's an attitude. You know, what do I eat? I don't know. Is there something in the cupboard? Is there some crackers or something? Okay, let me eat some crackers here and peanut butter and that's it. And let me what do I eat it off of? Just off of the counter. I just get a cracker, put some peanut butter on a cracker and just eat it. Finger food. I don't even have a plate. So I don't care what kind of, you know, silverware I have. Flatware, silverware, cooking utensils. I don't even cook. Just put some peanut butter on a piece of bread. Use a toaster, bread, and some peanut butter. Or cashew butter, sesame seed butter, whatever. And I just eat it straight. I don't even use utensils or plates or anything. So I could care less what a kitchen looks like or what all the fancy stuff you have in the cabinets of your kitchen are. I don't even use any of them. I use a NutriBullet plastic container, you know, I just drink my smoothie straight out of it. That's it. Pretty much that's it. I don't you know, don't care about any of that stuff. I don't care about furniture. I don't care about decor. My room is just blank white walls with a bunch of patches in them. A bunch of patches. No curtains, you know, old blinds. I mean, it's just bare bones. Bare bones, nothing, basically. It's like a monastic cell, pretty much so. Eat off paper plates. We eat plates, a napkin or a paper plate or something. That's it. And I could care less about all that stuff. If I had $1 billion, I'd still care less. I'd still just eat peanut butter off a piece of toast. Because I don't care about food. I'm not interested in food. I'm not interested in all this stuff. You know, nice paint on the wall. No, just plain white. It's fine. Just sheetrock. It's just painted sheetrock with a bunch of holes in it that have been plastered over or something. And that's the decor I have. I'm perfectly content. I don't even pay attention to it. I'm paying attention to a picture of Sri Sri Ananda my Ma is what I'm paying attention. I'm not paying attention to the room. The room I'm in, I could care less what the room I'm in is like, actually. I've got my attention on you know, where's God? How can I let that gentle glory imperceptibly dawn upon my mind? That's where my attention is. I don't care about the room I'm in. You know, just the bed I'm in, the chair I'm in, whatever. The bathroom I'm in, I don't even care. I don't even look at it. I don't even pay attention to it. The car I'm in, what I don't pay attention to. I don't pay attention to how people are dressed. I don't pay attention to what they look like. I don't care what someone looks like. It doesn't matter. So I could be sitting in the dust somewhere. It doesn't matter. I wouldn't even notice it, really. It's not important. It's where's your attention? The attention is how do I get you know, free of my bias against certainty? How do I settle these doubts down? You know, that's the question, right? It's not what does your decor look like? What does your yard look like? That's not the question. It's what does your mind look like? What does your mind look like? You know, how do you get free of these doubts? How do you be liberated from this bias, really? And we know how that's done. You hold on to one thought to the exclusion of all others, and every time you get knocked off that, you come right back to that thought. It could be just wow. It could be that simple. You just say wow. 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 That's a perfect, perfect, perfect practice. Just wow. Keep it simple, just wow. And every time you suddenly you're off on some scenario of how you're going to save the world, just go, wow, right back to wow. Right back to wow. Because no matter what you do to save the world, if you don't have that peace of God that's imperceptibly present, you're not going to save the world. Because only that really reaches people beyond all the doubt that they have. You know, otherwise they'll just be spinning in doubt. They'll just be, there's a way to relabel doubt. I can redecorate my doubt. You know, oh, here's somebody with some non-dual talk. Oh, I can redecorate my doubt. Great. But when you have like the presence of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, or Ram Maharshi, or Jamyang Khenchi Chokyi Lodro, that is felt by people. They feel it. It's not what you think, it's what you feel. They feel it. But it's a spiritual feeling. It's not an emotional, feminine type of feeling. Women say, oh, we feel. No, it's not that type of feeling. It's not what my feelings are. It's deeper than that. It's deeper than that. It's this wow feeling. It's this numinous feeling. I call it this wow feeling. There's something numinous. There's something that just melts my expectations. It goes beyond my expectations totally. It's just, I can't grasp it. I cannot grasp it. It's not graspable. Wow. And that reminds them, oh my gosh, that reminds me of where? Of home. of reality. It reminds me of reality. And so that motivates them. They say, I want that. Forget about my new house. I want that feel. I want that feeling to stay with me. I want that feeling to stay with me. How do I get that? At some point, they might just say, "You know what? Chasing after affluence, the dragon, chasing after the dragon of affluence. I'm going to die that way, and I'm not going to get it." Yeah, I might have a nice retirement, assisted living, some nice third world person is going to be feeding me my medications 3 times a day. I'll probably have about 20 of them. And probably I'll feel like hell inside. And then I'll be able to have like all these surgeries. And they'll keep me alive with, you know, cutting out all sorts of body parts and stuff. And I'll be able to go to the beauty parlor once a week or twice a week and still look like I'm, you know, a doll or something, you know, an affluent doll. But inside, I know I'm just rotting away, and I'm stinking, and I got no more strength, and I'm watching these putrid programming on television, and I'm hateful. I hate everybody, and I'm gonna die soon. Yeah, that's how it'll be. That's how it'll be if you don't get motivated. It's exactly how it'll be if you don't get motivated. And only this, those who allow the gentle glory to imperceptibly dawn upon them and stay with them, only those really motivate. Really motivate. Again, the first time I laid eyes on Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, instantly I had this incredible motivation just suddenly blazed forth. And I realized, this is it. I'll never lose it. You know, I'm a lifer. You know, she just convinced me like that in a video of her just walking across some dirt. Instantly, I became convinced and motivated. I said, what Jesus is telling me in A Course in Miracles is true. I know it's true. Doubt just left me like that. I know it's true. So I'm not going to stop until I succeed because I have faith that it's true. I know it's true. And so by working at it, and working at it, and working at it, I'm going to succeed without any doubt whatsoever. I will succeed eventually. Eventually. And that certainty came upon me. Okay? Came upon me instantly. Just the first sight, the first glimpse of her. That's all it took. That's all it took. That's how profound it is. But I was right, of course, because I had been using my faith as much as I could use it. But I was still saying, you know, I don't, am I going to make it? I don't know. Is it possible what Jesus says? Is it possible to actually be here in this world like this, what he was telling us? And then I saw it and I said, yes, it is possible. Instantly I said, yes, it is possible, because here it is. So, you know, that was the turning point of my life, of my spiritual path. And it hasn't been easy. It hasn't been easy. But I'm getting there, you see. Because I know it's possible. I know it's possible. And I needed to see somebody. Jesus told me it was possible, but I needed to see it was possible. Especially in today's world, right? And they said, there it is. So if you're right, that reaction, you can get it just instantly. Even from a distance, even from a video, even from a picture, you know, you just get it, you can get it instantly. But I got it from a video, because I saw just her walking and the way people were she was interacting with people. And that's the flow of her interaction is what I saw. And then I realized she's got it. 100%. 100%. And what Jesus said is possible. Jesus said it is possible to flow in this world in this way. It is possible to do this. And I saw she was doing it. Perfect flow. Perfect flow in the now. Perfect certainty of God with her. And it was just effortless flow. And everybody was also in the flow with her too. Nothing threw her off. It was just, you know, somebody came running up to her and threw herself at her feet in the dust. And she stopped like this. Didn't throw her flow off one bit. And then when the moment was ripe for her to move on, instantly she moved on. And it was seamless. It was all, everything was seamless. It was all seamless. Most astonishing thing I've ever seen, or ever will see, actually, in this world. There was no thought taking place at all. It was all pure grace, just a flow of pure grace. No thought needed. Completely spontaneous in the now. She was that way her entire life, without ever leaving it for one instant. So what Jesus tells us is true in A Course in Miracles. Absolutely true. And his promise to us is absolutely true. We can be that way too. Now he tells us, perhaps you may not reach perfectly that way as you spend your time in the rest of your time in this world. That's an honest appraisal, right? Perhaps. But he says, you can reach that if really you want to, you can. There's nothing blocking you, really, from God's standpoint, from being that way. But maybe you'll honor time a little longer in a certain way. That's possible, too, he says. But just keep in mind that you can be this way. This very instant, you can be this way. So I know what Jesus tells us in A Course in Miracles is true. And so we could have this as a goal. We can have this as a goal for ourselves. Absolutely, we can. And we should. We should. So let the fruit ripen. Let the fruit ripen. And when it's ready, it'll drop. Like this morning, I get up in the morning, I look up at the sky, I say, oh my God, it's so beautiful. It's so softly, it's so, why is it so beautiful? I told myself, why is the sky so beautiful? Because I don't know. I don't know why. And then I sort of started driving around. I said, wait a minute, everything is beautiful. Why is everything so beautiful? I don't know why. But it all seems so softly gentle. It seems so You know, just this gentleness and softness to everything and smoothness, and it feels so beautiful. It feels so kind. Sort of a hush is upon everything. This beautiful, quiet softness is upon everything. This beautiful, quiet softness is upon everything. Wow. I love it. I love it. I say, I want to feel this way all the time. Because I remember previously in my lifetimes I felt this way. And I say, I just love this feeling. I want this. I want to feel this way every way. Always. All the time. All the time. This soft hush upon the land, upon everything. Everything feels still. It's just somehow immersed in its own stillness. Assuaged in its own intrinsic spaciousness. Everything feels assuaged in its own intrinsic spaciousness. That's what I felt this morning. And it wasn't just a glimpse. It lasted and lasted and lasted for hours. And I just let it last. I said, I'm fine with this. It's okay. I just want to enjoy this for a while. And how it came upon me is it's imperceptible, indescribable, imperceptible. And it's imperceptibly present, you know, imperceptibly present. Everything assuaged in its own spaciousness. Everything assuaged in its own spaciousness. Even Trump assuaged in his own spaciousness. Yeah, right. Everything assuaged in its own spaciousness. So have a good laugh about it. You need to laugh about it because it is funny. I mean, you deserve to laugh about how silly you've been. How silly, right, doubt is. How silly it is. You deserve to have a good laugh about it. And it's getting kind of, what time is it? I don't know. It's a good taping, right? 3 hours. You deserve 3 hours. Longchenpa said, give him 3 hours. Our blessed Dharma King Longchenpa said, give him 3 hours. So, I just gave you 3 hours of some really beautiful Dharma sharing, you know, right? Body of Christ sharing, Sangha sharing, three jewels. Dedicate the merit to the precious guru and the three jewels. That's Buddhist dedication. Dedicate it to your guru and the three jewels. The guru, the teaching, and the Sangha, right? So we dedicate it to the three jewels. We dedicate it to the body of Christ. And we get dedicated to the lotus feet of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. This 3 hours, okay? May it benefit all of us. May it be beneficial for generations and generations to come, all the way to the end of time, to the end of the belief in time, to the belief that hallucinating an absence of reality is some sort of place or process or time. It's just a hallucination. It's not some other, it's not hallucinating an absence of eternity is not time. We just label it so. We just label it so. Hallucinating the absence of reality is not a place. We just label it. We say place, you know. Put a place, label place. It's not a place. It's just a hallucination of the absence of what's there. So have a good laugh about it. You know, have a good laugh about it. Have some fun with it. Have some fun with it. You have some, even Trump is assuaged in his own spaciousness. Perfectly. Perfectly so. Beautifully, gently, softly, gloriously so. Everything is. Have a good laugh. I have fun with it. I have fun with it. Got to, right? Have fun with the madness of the world as you see through it. People just have lost their sense of humor. This is what some of the older people tell me. They said, my God, what's happened to the world? They have no more sense of humor. They just cannot laugh at the silliness of it all. You know, you can't point out how silly they are. You used to be, you point out how someone's being silly, and instead of saying that you're bigoted or racist or something, they would say, oh my gosh, you're right, that's hilarious. And then we'd both roar with laughter, you know, about it. How silly I was. You know what? That's how we used to be. We would laugh at our old foolishness, our own silliness, our own stupidity. And people would point it out to us. That was humor, pointing out each other's foibles. Just, hey, you just forgot about Jesus, didn't you? He said, my God, I did. That is Ridiculous, isn't it? And then we'd have a good laugh about it. The culture was admonishing culture, but we taught ourselves to have a good laugh about our silliness, you know. We just doubted God. How silly. How absolutely silly. Let's have a good chuckle about it, and then we're done with it. That's the humor we used to have, and now that will get you in prison. We'll get you imprisoned. They'll get you imprisoned. Yeah, we can't share our sense of humor, this beautiful sense of humor we used to have. And it was a living sense of humor. It was an ongoing sense of humor. I used to, my uncles, you know, I used to just, it was nonstop humor. When we get together with them, just nonstop humor. Everything was funny. Everything was funny. Eating, it was hilarious. I said, oh, looks like you're stuffing yourself like a pig. He says, oh yeah, I am, aren't I? He says, wow. And then they start pantomiming something, you know, and we just, we'd recognize, we'd point out our bad habits to one another, and then we'd recognize them, lampoon them. We'd lampoon ourselves. We'd lampoon ourselves and say, what an idiot I am. He said, yeah. He says, but we're getting better, right? And then we'd turn our attention to something better, right? We'd say, yeah, we're idiots. And let's have a good laugh about that. And so let's see how we can do better. Say, oh yeah, let's do better. My uncle was super austere. My uncle was like almost like Rama Maharshi in his austerity, actually. He cared almost nothing for his appearance or his decor or how or anything, you know. He was just, music was his thing. That was all he ever thought about. He was living in a pigsty. As long as he had his violin, he didn't care about anything else. Singing and music was everything to him. And we had to kind of help him out because, you know, he's like, you've been wearing the same jacket for about 20 years now and it's like filthy. And he didn't even notice. He said, and he makes some big joke about it. He says, oh yeah, I remember I got that stain at this place here, and I wear that proudly, and this one here, you know. So he make a big joke about it. So we joke about our austerity, you know, and we had to come clean his house up because it was so terrible. I don't know, I was pretty there. I helped out with all that. I tried to spiff him up a little bit because I don't think he liked it very much, actually. I was trying to do him a favor, but it was, people didn't want to come to visit. It was so filthy, you know. I said, can't we just like sweep it up? But I think maybe it killed him, you know, because it changed his environment and made him more conscious of his environment. And he didn't want to be conscious of his environment. I had a feeling he resented it. I was trying to help modernize him a little bit because, so he wouldn't die, you know, is what it was. I didn't want him to die. And I saw he was going to die. And so I said, maybe if you just can become a little more modernized, maybe you'd be willing to stick around for a while. But it didn't work. He wanted to die. He wanted no part of the modern world. He told me, he says, 5 years from now, it's going to be hell here. Well, he's right. He was right. So I couldn't keep him alive. I failed. And I'm very sad I failed. I tried because you would have loved him. You would have loved him. I said, Uncle, we need people like you in the world because if you're gone, there's not going to be anybody like you. Someone who embraces austerity without any bitterness whatsoever, without any self-pity whatsoever. You absolutely embrace extreme austerity and poverty and without any feeling of, you know, poor me. In fact, you're oblivious to it. He was oblivious to it. He wasn't even aware that he was austere. And I said, my God, you know, we need you. Don't die. And when he started having trouble, I intuitively became aware he was starting to have troubles. And I thought, uh-oh, he might pass away. I said, I want to keep him alive. I need him. And when he was gone, it was real tough for me because he was like a model, role model for me, of embracing austerity like that. For me, for my generation, you become too much of an anomaly if you're like that. People think you're on drugs, you're a meth addict or something. You're cuckoo. They won't even be around you at all. So I have to keep some sort of modern facade So, you know, it's the way that things went. But yeah, it was almost like meeting Ram Maharshi, but he didn't have the realization of Ramana. But he would give you anything. He'd give you anything. You know, no, yeah, nothing had except his violin. But you know, he'd even give that. He said, "Well, another one will come along." I mean, if you needed something, he would give you everything and anything, even though he had nothing, almost nothing. If he felt that you needed it more than him, or you wanted something, here it is. No charge. He'd just give you the shirt off his back. He tried a business to survive, and it completely failed because he just give stuff away to people. Or, you know, if he saw someone was poor, he said, "You like that? Take it, take it, take it." He tried to have an antique shop, but he kept giving stuff away to people, and it failed. You know, it broke my heart. You know, he worked so hard on that antique shop, like he slaved on it. Manual labor. He did manual labor for everybody, and he had an antique shop, and it completely failed. You know, and his vehicle finally failed. He didn't have money to fix it. We had to buy him a car, and then that failed too because we didn't. You know, it wasn't good enough. We couldn't modernize him. You know, whatever we did, it failed. He didn't want to be modernized at all. But I hope he can forgive me because he has to understand that, you know, we need help. We're getting crushed. And he was one of the most helpful people you'll ever meet, spiritually helpful people you will ever meet. I mean, his sense of humor, just devastating. Just everybody just loved to be around him because it's just, you just look at him and you just burst out in laughter. You know, he's just like, because he was oblivious to it all. Total genius, like an IQ of like 180, something like that, maybe 160 plus. I don't know. It was like super, super, super high. Photographic memory, completely photographic memory, encyclopedic knowledge about everything. A near opera star. You know, his singing was you know, opera star quality. Genius musician. Beautiful, great musician, great singer. Super morals, immaculate morals, as far as I know. He would drop anything he was doing if you asked him for help. If you asked him to help, he would immediately drop whatever he was doing and immediately help you do anything you asked. He said, "I need these rocks carried, you know, for a day." Or just, he'd drop everything and to help you out, and wouldn't ask a dime for it. Wouldn't ask a dime for it. And never felt that he was bitter about any of it, but I think he resented trying to modernize him. You know, but so I've kind of got a guilty conscience a little bit about that of trying to help him out. But you know, I say, "Hey, you're gonna die anyway. You know, at least I'm gonna try to help you stay alive." We, you know, selfish, but the same, it's the Dharma, the same thing. Just like people keep Tibetan lamas alive as long as they can, because they say, "Hey, we need you here, and you should live as long as you possibly can here." And I feel this way, and I actually ended up modernizing myself. I think if I hadn't have done that, I might have died myself. I would already been dead, actually. Because I would have just been like him, and he can't survive that way anymore. And so he probably saved my life. And in that, doing that probably helped the world out a lot. Because I just didn't care anymore at all. But by trying to help him out, I ended up having to modernize myself. And now I've been able to, you know, stick with the modern world enough to function here, to put out the Dharma as much as I can here. And try to live a long life to help. It's a responsibility, I feel. You can't just say, "Ah, the world's gone to hell and let me just die and leave it." I don't feel that's right. Unless we're all leaving it because God's grace tells us we all got to leave here because it's not going to work. But other than that, I feel you should stick around as long as possible, even if you're sick and infirm and feeble and weak. And keep giving him the presence, because the presence of God won't leave you just because the body's old. Not at all. Never left Sri Sri Nandamayi Maharaj Maharshi for one instant. Not for one instant. so people could come to them even when they're sick. When Rama was sick with cancer in the arm and stuff, they could still come to him and get the blessing, and it was still totally profound, just as profound as ever, really. But I wish Rana would stay longer. And for some reason, he said that he was more helpful on the other unmanifest for now, and he wanted to leave the scene. That's fine. The Dharmic, sometimes they do that. But you know, Sri Sri Anmayama stayed for 86 years. I don't know how long Rama stayed, but it was a pretty good run, right? It was like at least 70 plus, right? Something like that. I was born in what? Was it 1879 or in the 1870s, something like that? So that'd be 20 years, and then he died in 1950, so 70 plus years, I believe. Jamyang died pretty young. Some of the Tibetans died pretty young. I think he was like in his 50s or something. I don't think he died in 59, right? I don't know exactly when he was born, but he wasn't that old when he passed away. He wasn't aged by any means. Longchenpa died when he was pretty young. He was only 56, I think. Of course, Jesus died quite young. Padmasambhava left this world. I don't think he was that. I don't know. He was, may have been hundreds of years old, because he didn't age. I don't, you know, he just didn't age, didn't die, any of that stuff. But I like those venerable old lamas, venerable old sages, who give us the opportunity to help us with our austerity. It helps to see them okay with their situation. It helps us a lot. That even when we're old, the gentle glory of God will not leave us at all. Because the failure of the body senses that doesn't affect it at all, actually. Because it's something that's felt. It's not perceived, it's felt. It's awareness. There's an awareness that's not the body senses that are aware of it, actually. So the body senses can fail, but you're still aware of the gentle glory of God. That everything is assuaged in its own spaciousness. It's felt that way. It's felt to be so. It's felt to be so. So I don't feel like stopping. I'm on such a roll right now. Did I eat dinner? I don't know. I can't remember. Maybe I did eat something. Yeah. A Caesar salad. Some lettuce. And some tabbouleh or some kind of ancient grain. Some sort of bulgur wheat or something. And some feta cheese, I think. Yeah. Feta cheese on some cold sprouted green kind of salad mix with some lettuce and croutons, Caesar salad like thing. I just sort of snacked on that, and if I'm preparing meals for others, I have to do that every day, and so I just kind of snack on, I'll eat like half the salad or something, and that's it. That's good enough. I don't need a prepared meal. You know, have a banana and peanut butter. My uncle would be that way. He'd always put stuff in his jacket, like a banana or a peanut butter sandwich or something, some nuts. And that's all he'd eat. He'd go somewhere and have a little bag, plastic bag of nuts, mixed nuts, and he'd eat the mixed nuts, and that was it. And he'd carry a glass jar of water with him in his pocket somewhere, and he'd just drink from this glass jar of water. I still have that glass jar of water with the water that he had in it when he passed away. And just a Kerr jar. Just a Kerr jar. Can last, if you don't break it, it can last hundreds of years, can it? He was like a yogi, you know, a renunciate yogi in a lot of ways, really. He must have been from Tibet or India previously, his previous lives. He must have been very, very, very advanced, a super yogi in one of those places. You know, his habits were so refined, spiritually refined, astonishingly so. Everybody remarked upon it. They just said, wow, this man is very kind, compassionate man. He must have had so much exposure to some sort of high Buddhist culture, I would say, or Hindu culture, or Christian culture. It could have been any of those, but my God, the kindness was just oozing out of him every moment. There's nothing he did that wasn't kind, actually. There's no action or thought or word he ever spoke that wasn't kind. That is true. He never said a bad thing about anyone. He could tell it like it is. You know, he'd say, look, the world's got problems. You know, but an unkind word or unkind action to anyone was impossible for him, I believe. He could not come from him. I said, how do you do this, Uncle? I mean, just how are you this way? It's just so amazing. If you spoke ill of somebody, he would speak up and say, no, it's probably because of this, you know, or I'm sure that they're a wonderful person. And graciousness, you might say he just was overflowing with graciousness. He came from a Midwestern background, Christian Midwest background, where people were so gracious, you know, slightly Southern, you know, Missouri-ish type of background of you know, that graciousness where you just are gracious to everyone without fail. And this is what we're lacking, isn't it? This graciousness in our culture, with graciousness without fail. I mean, the political climate of this culture, of this country, world, is so uncivil, so ungracious, it's unbelievable. People are just hateful to one another. And where we should be unfailingly gracious to one another. And that brings out, you know what it does? It brings out the best in us. It has faith in God. It's faith that God dwells in you as God dwells in me. And it will come out in us if we're gracious to one another. That will prevail. And this is true. And if we're not gracious, if we're hateful to one another, we're saying we don't believe God dwells in you. I don't believe God dwells in me. And therefore, I don't believe God dwells in you. And so I'm justified in hating you. And you know what it does? It brings out the worst in us. And this is what's happening in the world right now. The politicization of culture and the way things have gone in this world right now is going to hell. And just to have that sort of gracious person in the world, I said, you know what? That's worth all more money than all the money in the world. If I had the money, I said, I spent every dime I had on him to try to keep him alive. I said, we need your graciousness in this world. We need that example of this super, super graciousness. The ultimate gentleman. He was the ultimate gentleman. He would never take advantage of anyone. If, you know, if he found $1 billion, he would kill himself to give it back to whoever lost it. Honest, completely honest, completely fair. You know, just all the whole gamut of graciousness, the virtues. You know, they were just overflowing in him, overflowing, all the time. And he was oblivious to it. You know, I mean, he was not even aware of it. I said, Uncle, I mean, you're amazing, and just as long as he could sing a song to somebody, he was happy. And join in, join in and sing with me. He was, you know, that he lived just for that. So it's important to sing the praises of people like this, right? That we should have a culture that should sing the praises of these people that we meet who are like this, and say, my God, it's possible, but I don't see anyone like him today. I really don't. And when he passed away, we realized, you know, we're doomed. I mean, we're just not going to find people like that anymore. Sometimes these real old people are still this way. You meet them and they're so gracious. They're so gracious. And they treat you like you're a child of God. No questions asked. Upon meeting you, they don't need anything about you. It doesn't matter. They don't need to. For them, you're a child of God. And that's all there is to it. There's nothing you can do about it to change their mind either. You know, they never will think ill of you. This is the graciousness of the older, real old generation. They will not think ill of you. And that brings out the best of you, and you love them for it. And so I was super blessed to have an uncle like that. Super, super blessed. So, you know, be aware of your blessings. Be aware of your blessings. And my dad, of course, was a super yogi. Very intense, very intense, very disciplined, very serious about it. Very aware of it. So I was super blessed by my dad as well. He had to be an itinerant, you know, one of Shankara's itinerant monks, traveling from ashram to ashram to ashram. Like, you can't stay longer than 3 days there, because that was totally within him, in his blood. He couldn't handle family life, because he had to move constantly. He had to keep moving, and so he spent the rest of his life moving around the world, constantly shifting his location. Like, because in India, if you're a renunciate, one of the holy orders of India, you're expected to keep moving around. You don't set up shop somewhere. You know, you stay at ashram, and then after a short period of time, you walk to the next one. And so you keep moving, you walk there. And he was a fabulous walker. He walked everywhere. He got that from his previous lives in India, for sure. For sure. He was super attracted to India. He went there basically and stayed there, walking all over India. He got that because he was a yogi in one of the renunciate orders of India in previous lives. There's no doubt about it. Probably many lives. So he was, you know, totally hatha yoga. He was a genius at it. Meditation, all this stuff. Super austere in his eating habits. His purity habits were immaculate. Immaculate is his habit. So he was a really high yogi in India previously. But not realized. Not a sage. Not a sage. But he had all the habits that ultimately lead to being a sage. And he had many glimpses of the general glory of God. He had many glimpses of it. So those were my role models. Those were my mentors. That's what I was blessed enough to grow up with. And then I get the Dharma Kings as mentors. So I've led a super blessed life, although it's been extremely difficult to keep my faith in this apex yoga, you know, in this world where we're trying to water, everyone's faith is being watered down. I'm the one that got hit the hardest by that. If you're just a once a week Christian going to church, you know, things haven't bothered you for the last 50 too much, although they're getting bothered now because they're under attack. But yeah, you have, you know, kind of a really kind of feeble faith, and yeah, a little faith in Jesus stuff. But if you have this super faith that I had, I was just absolutely sure of the Dharma Kings and what they're going to do in the future, what they're going to do for me, and how they interact with us. I was aware of all of that, and I knew it. I was aware of it, directly aware of it all. So I had this super faith, and I know I have super faith in eternal life and all of that. So that is just, you know, people think now you're completely cuckoo. So when the world's trying to, Marxism's trying to water down everyone's faith down to the lowest common denominator, people like myself, they're the ones who look like a complete anomaly, like they're crazy. So I had an extremely difficult time in this world, hideously difficult time, to keep my faith at that high level. When everybody else was allowing their faith to be watered down, they said, yeah, I used to believe certain that, but I don't really believe in that anymore, but I'm dead my face down here now, but I feel comfortable with it, you know. So the downward spiral was so strong that, you know, it tried to pull me down, you know, and I had a hideous time, you know, keeping it. If it weren't for the Dharma Kings, I couldn't have kept it at all. If it weren't for the grace of God, it would have been impossible. And so now, though, I seem like an anomaly, because the way I speak and my faith is just, most people just think I just, like, you know, it's just, wow, it's too much, too much. But now this is just normal. For me, it's just normal. And it should be much more than this, actually. Much more than this. All things are possible with God. As Jesus said, if your faith has the size of a mustard seed, you tell that mountain to move, that mountain's going to move right this instant. No questions asked. You're the Holy Son of God. The entire universe rushes in to do whatever your bidding is instantly with great joy. That is absolutely true. So I absolutely believe in all the miracles of Jesus and all the saints throughout history. I totally believe in them. I read Autobiography of a Yogi by Yogananda. I believed everything he said. I said, absolutely, this is true. And more, a lot more. You know, I didn't doubt any of it. And I said, oh, yeah, absolutely, this is great. Way to speak up, Yogananda. Thank you for the help. Very, very helpful, Yogananda. Very, very helpful. But then I tried to tell everybody about it, and they thought, you know, this guy's got a really vivid imagination. He's got to grow up. I mean, he's got the imagination of a kid. No, I had the untainted awareness of someone who hadn't yet been corrupted by the doubt of this world. Okay, it didn't have to do with the fact that I was a young person, a child. It had to do with my awareness hadn't, you know, the propaganda hadn't, you know, gotten to it yet. Hadn't been subverted yet. By the doubt structure of this consciousness of this world here, which is just the projection of everybody that comes here, collective projection throughout history of those who have come here and projected their doubt here upon the world, upon this hallucination, really. It's just a hallucination, actually. This world is just a hallucination. The way we're seeing it is just a hallucination. And so the world's been trying to, you know, pull me down my entire life. And again, if you're already down to that, all watered down, you think, I don't feel much pressure. But if you're way up here with your faith, you feel like there's, you know, you're walking on air here because there's no support underneath your feet at all here anymore. It's a devastating situation. And I've seen so many collapse around me, you know, they can't sustain it. And they've watered it down. They can't talk with me anymore. You know, I'm too intense. They say I'm too intense. Or when I was younger, people, we could converse. We could converse on stuff. I could converse with my dad like this. For sure, yeah. My uncle, too, to some extent. He might, a little too intense, he might laugh about some of it. Yeah, I'd say, no, yeah, anything can happen. I mean, why put limitations on perfection? And whatever needs to happen will happen. And, you know, they'd say, yeah, they agreed with that, that the perfect synchronicity, you know, and the grace of God, now everything, you know, my dad would notice that all the time. He'd say, wow. And we'd laugh. He'd say, it's unbelievable, isn't it? And I'd say, yeah. Did you see that? I say, yeah, I saw it. Did you see that, how that all worked out? I say, yeah. And he said, wow, that is just hilarious. That is just amazing, isn't it? I say, yeah, it's just fabulous, isn't it? And we just roar with laughter about it. Because it's so sublime, it's so great, you can't help but laugh at how amazing it all is. But you do that now, and most people, you know, think you're nuts. But not all, but it's too intense. I'm too intense for people. For most people, a few are still hanging in there. A few are still hanging in there. You know, they're not quite extinct yet. We're not quite extinct yet. But we could be. I mean, I'm not saying that I'm, you know, that the world can't get me down. Yeah, it could. It certainly could. They're doing everything they can. I mean, it's just, you know, it's kind of like all non-dual talk in the world now is also mixed with extreme activist hate. You know, you talk about a bummer. That's a real bummer. You talk about dragging people down. That's a big drag down, man. That's a bad trip right there, because you love the non-dual awareness and talk, but the amount of hate there and the amount of activist hate there is just, you know, you gotta drink that too. You know, so it's like you know, drinking the Kool-Aid. It's spiked Kool-Aid. You know, it's spiked with cyanide or something. You know, hey, drink this nice Kool-Aid. you know, non-dual Kool-Aid, but oh, Jim Jones has, you know, spiked it. It's like that. So it's always a bummer, you know. It gets me depressed a little bit. You know, I brush it off, but it takes enormous effort to brush it off. Because I know that you know, they're drinking the hate Kool-Aid. The hate Kool-Aid, that's totally toxic to the presence of God, you know, to be upon you, truly upon you. Truly upon you. Like Sri, it should be upon us like it's upon Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. It should be upon us like that. And just looking at her picture, it's just, I'm transfixed. My attention can't move. It can't even move. And after a while, I got to say, wow, you know, I got to, you know, function. Wait a minute. I could go on like this, you know, forever. You know, my attention can't move. It's just, I can just see the, you know, the grace of God. I can just see it. I can feel it. And it's unwavering. It's complete and unwavering. And it's an astonishment. So, anyway, wow. Right? Wow, 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 wow. Just try that practice. Just try it. And just say, hold on to just one thought, one word, one concept, one phrase. And just repeat it. And just, it doesn't matter how much you repeat it. Just keep your attention on it. Just keep your attention on it and find out what happens. Find out how the mind, your habits try to divert you away from that. But that's the settling down. Just keep doing it. Don't worry if you're diverted. It's settling down. The more you do that, the more your doubt settles down. And when your doubt has settled down, it's easy for the gentle glory of God to imperceptibly dawn upon you. To dawn upon you in this imperceptible manner, really. This imperceptible manner. It's there. It's just there. We can't perceive how it got there at all. It came upon us imperceptibly. It always does. It's that gentle. It's imperceptibly gentle. It is truly imperceptibly gentle. This is a fact. So if you have this experience, that's the general glory of God dawning upon you when it's just imperceptibly gentle. So there's nothing you can say about it at all, really, right? You can't structure it at all. It's imperceptibly gentle, imperceptibly soft, imperceptibly glorious, and everything is imperceptibly assuaged in its own spaciousness. There's no process to this at all. There's no process to perceive. It's imperceptible. It's imperceptible. Very great. So, we're going to wrap this one up because, you know, I might just vanish if I keep saying this. I keep on with this. I might just be assuaged in my own spaciousness and ascend or something. I don't know what. So, very great. Oh, you know, I have to keep on, don't we, with this mad world that we're in. It really is. We're in the bottom of the barrel right now. But don't go extinct. Don't go extinct and hang in there. If I can hang in here with all the pressure to collapse my faith down into a lower state, toxic state, you can hang in there. You can hang in also, right? Because I doubt that the pressure is any more severe on you than it is on me to compromise your faith, right? So if I can keep my faith real sharp and uncompromised, you can too, right? So let's do it together, and keep calling on the Dharma Kings. They have a plan. They've promised me at the right moment they will take the right action. They will. There's no doubt about that. The Apex Array will do so. So we just have to, you know, hang in there, all right? So again, this, the merit of all of this, let's dedicate it to the Dharma Kings, because it will come back 1,000-fold to everyone. Very great. That's it for this video.